Good morning and welcome to the 34th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind anyone using electronic devices to please turn them to silent. Our first item of business this morning is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Our members agreed. Thank you. Our first item of business is our third roundtable on the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Bill. And today's evidence session will focus on on-farm nature restoration, climate mitigation and adaptation. And we'll also discuss the bill more widely. We have up to 3 hours this morning for discussion. And I welcome to the meeting David Harley, the Chief Officer from Circular Economy from Scottish Environmental Protection Agency. Stuart Goodall, the Chief Executive of CONFOR, Kirsty Tate, Director for Scotland for Food, Farming and Countryside Commission Scotland, Ross Lilly, the Head of Nature Resources Management, Nature Scot. We've got Professor David Ray, Executive Director from the Edinburgh Climate Change Institute, Ross McLeod, the Head of Policy Scotland for the Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust, Vicky Swales, the Head of Land Use Policy from RSPB Scotland. Joining us remotely, we've got Professor David McCracken, Head of Integrated Land Management from SRUC. And we have Ewan Ross, the Scottish Manager for Nature Friendly Farming Networks, Eleanor Kay, Senior Policy Advisor from Scottish Land and Estates, and Alistair Seaman, the Director for Scotland for the Woodland Trust. As I say, as you've just heard, we've got a lot of participants this morning, so I ask everyone to be succinct in their questions and answers. And when responding to a question, please indicate to me or the clerk if you wish to participate. But if you feel your point has already been made, please just indicate that you agree or disagree, and then we'll move on to the next question. So I'm going to kick off. We're going to look at the various themes and the four objectives of the agricultural policy set out in the bill. So what I'm seeking your views on what facilitation of on-farm nature restoration, climate mitigation, adaptation actually means, and will the bill as it currently stands be able to deliver it? Who would like to kick off? Vicky Swales.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, there's an awful lot wrapped up in that statement about facilitating on-farm nature restoration. I would say that in terms of the powers the bill is creating, we should not just be thinking about necessarily entirely on-farm, although that will be a large part of what needs to happen. This bill also makes provisions for woodland and forestry grants and for other land management, as is the case already under the cap. So it's actually a bit broader than on-farm. But nonetheless, what we need to happen is for farming to transition much more to the wide-scale adoption of nature and climate-friendly farming methods. And that means absolutely embedding those methods within all farming systems, within our food production systems from the start. It means, at the very start, complying with legislation, but then it means working through that, undertaking the kind of measures on farms. So practical things we might think about in an arable setting, for example, hedges, field margins, fallows, stubbles, all those are things that can help nature, can also contribute to tackling climate change. We also need other habitats created, some of which we've lost historically in Scotland as a result of land use and agricultural changes. And we need, of course, that to include a wide raft of measures which can help to mitigate climate change, but also adapt to climate change as well, because we're already facing that. So this bill will create powers for the government to introduce its four-tier framework, and there are measures within all those tiers which should be contributing towards delivering for nature and climate-friendly farming methods on farms. So in terms of, we've got an objective at the minute, we would argue that that objective itself needs slightly tweaking to be broader, to talk about maintaining and enhancing farmland biodiversity, but also contributing to nature restoration and ecosystem regeneration more widely. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move to Davy McCracken and then Davy Ray.
Okay. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you for allowing me to input via this route rather than being there in person. I think it's best for all of us concerned that I'm at some distance from you. Yes, just I think One thing that is implicit but should be much more explicit in the Vicky, the answers given there, the answer that Vicky's given there is, why should farmers want and need to actually do more for nature and climate on their farms? We've got a big job to do to actually explain to farmers across Scotland why they should be actually engaging going forward. And so, you know, fundamentally, yes, farmers have a role to play in helping address biodiversity declines. Yes, farmers have a, and crofters have a role to play in terms of helping to actually address ongoing climate change. But as Vicky's mentioned, fundamentally, they need to make some of these changes on their farms and crofts going forward in order to adapt to the ongoing climate change. We're going to see severe droughts in Scotland once in every two or three years going forward, rather than once in every 20 years. We're going to see, we've already had severe weather in the Highlands just over the weekend. We had severe weather down the east coast of Scotland a couple of months ago, double the rainfall. The types of things that farmers can do with what's called nature conservation measures, climate change adaptation and mitigation measures will actually help make their farms much more resilient. And that is one of the main messages that needs to go out to farmers in Scotland and crofters in Scotland sooner rather than later, that they're not doing this for wider society, they're doing this for themselves. Otherwise, as Vicky's already said, the framework, and it is a framework, provides for the type of legislation that's needed to actually evolve the policies to actually facilitate that change on the ground. Thank you.
Thank you. David Ray.
Good morning. I mean, backing up Vicky and Davy, really, the trouble I have with the objectives is there are only four, and so this one's got a huge amount in there, but it's not specific enough, I don't think, because these things are so important, because... I mean, looking at the four, and I know we're focused on C, but the enabling rural communities to thrive, for me, I mean, you can't disagree with that, but actually having something which says, right, that means fair work, it means more jobs and skills, all those kind of elements, I think that would have, if we compare it to what CAP's got, that greater depth as well as breadth, like Vicky was saying, I think would be really useful, because it kind of... It can mean everything to everyone, but it can also risk being a bit meaningless at that level. That's my view.
Would you suggest that we look at adding more objectives on top of the four to and make it slightly clearer on what the objectives actually are?
Yeah, totally. So if you take the four, they cover so many things, so you can read it and think, oh, that means something to me. But actually putting that, making that overt, I think would be really valuable.
Okay. I'm going to bring in you, and then I've got a supplementary from Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with what's been said, particularly David McCracken's point about this fundamentally being about farmer resilience, farm and croft resilience. You know, nature-friendly farming builds in resilience into the system. I think the points that needs to be made is that the objectives need a little bit more sort of substance behind them in terms of farmer and crofter position in the value chain. I know this has been raised at previous committee meetings, and I think the fundamental point about it is that, as David McCracken alludes to, there is this problem of farmers and crofters not necessarily seeing that resilience, but that's often because they're operating in quite precarious markets, and at least in terms of produce there is a market there is a market price, but with emergent markets over things like natural capital and things like that, the government needs to come in and see them as a valuable actor and part of the value chain, and they need to regulate that so that farmers and crofters have the confidence to access it and make their farms more resilient.
Okay. Kate, before I bring you in, Eleanor and Ross maybe want to make an initial comment. Eleanor.
Thanks. Really just building on what's already been said, but conscious of adding my own stuff to not upset the convener. This is about ensuring that throughout the new tiered system, there are linkages, that whatever farmers get in their whole farm plan recommendations clearly resonates with what's available to them within tier two and what they can do in tier three. And that's entirely backed up by the knowledge and CPD available and guidance in this tier four. When we get more detail, we can make sure there are linkages between all of these. Otherwise, we're not going to achieve anything. This is a major change for the sector, and we have to make sure that all the mechanisms and tools are in place for these to happen. And it could be that what we need to do is a very big body of work of habitat mapping and climate risk mapping in order to make the right decisions. And we're not there right now with information available to farmers. So I think the objectives in the bill are as broad as they need to be. The more detail we put in, the more we risk cutting something out. I think the rural support plan is where we will get that detail, but I'm happy to argue about it. But I think so much of this is down to communication, and current communication is not fit for purpose, and we must improve it as a matter of urgency. Before we get to 2027, we have got to start doing it now.
Okay, thank you. Ross?
Well, I'll try not to repeat because I'm at the end of the line here, but I think fundamentally this is about land and more essentially soils, really, at the end of the day, when it comes to nature, climate, and farming and food production. And why now? Why the bill and why farmers and crofters? Because actually they cover 70% of Scotland's land. Land has got to do a heck of a lot for Scotland, for society, in a way that's never had to do before. The last time we had this look at land was post-Second World War and the CAP. We've had 70 years of that, and now we're basically having to rebase all that. And so there's a lot of pressure on farmers and crofters here because they are essentially our stewards of the land. And I know working with a lot of farmers and crofters, they see themselves as that. Some don't see themselves as producers, but they're actually essentially our stewards. So that's why there's a lot of pressure from this bill on getting it right. But essentially, at the end of the day, it's about how they manage soils and get that right, and it'll do the work we need to do for these other public goods.
Okay, thank you. Kate, I'm still got. I will probably go right round because we've got other people indicating, then we can come in with your supplementary. So I've got Ross McLeod, and then David, and then Kirsty.
Thank you, Convener. One of the challenges we have with the bill as it stands at the moment, in terms of the sort of broad nature of the objectives, is, as Jim Fairley referred to in an earlier session, there are lots of moving parts, so lots of dependencies with other legislation that's going to come forward. Other activities, Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, Land Reform Bill. And I think it would improve the bill if there was something on the face of it to recognise the need for adaptability, which is something that the ministers and cabinet secretaries have referred to. At present, it's rather loose. And I think you pushed the point on several occasions during the sessions about how powers will be taken during secondary legislation, for instance. I do think we need some clarity to allow that flexibility as we learn and go forwards with what works, what doesn't, particularly in terms of outcomes, that there is something in the bill that recognises the need for that learning through adaptation.
David.
Yeah, just agreeing with many of the points made, but I'd just like to build on Vicky's point about this being an ecosystem. And if we start to rebuild this ecosystem, we will get multiple benefits. And that's just across the board in terms of climate change, climate resilience, food resilience. But I think just again, and also building on what Ross said, the fundamental importance of the soil here, that's the foundation of this whole system. And I think if we are more explicit about that in the objectives, and also on, I would say, water quality, a third of Scotland's water environment is downgraded by agriculture at the moment, far more than sewage.
Okay, thank you. Kirsty.
I think just going back to the question about objectives and understanding are these objectives enough, are they detailed enough? In my opinion, I think if we get the definition of sustainable and regenerative agriculture down, that in itself will enable nature restoration, climate mitigation, adaptation. Because if our farmers are practicing sustainable and regenerative agriculture, that you will see on farm change, you will see off farm change. So I think I think with the objectives in the centre, I think they're enough. But I think the detail has to come below it, and that's the purposes, isn't it? And I think we've been watching the discussions that's been happening, and I think that's where we can really start to really pull out what we mean.
Okay, thank you. Kate.
Thanks very much. As with all these things, already in the first sort of few minutes of evidence, we've heard some people say that they think this is about land, it's about ecosystems, it's about communities, it's about food. And do you think that we can manage all the different objectives simultaneously in a way that the previous cap system did actually quite effectively, because this is an agriculture and rural communities bill. So my two short questions are, do you think there's any inherent conflicts between the objectives as they stand? And secondly, do you think that there's a possibility of adding objectives and still retaining the focus?
Ross Lilly.
I would argue that what we've had used so far in terms of incentivising the right land management through farming, the Common Agricultural Policy has stifled a lot of the creativity that we need farmers to actually, and crofters to use. We need to put the tools in their hands to get it right, and I think we do, and there's plenty of examples across Scotland that I can point to where farmers and crofters are doing this. The farmers and crofters themselves can weave those multi-objectives into their land, their holding, in the way that works for them. And I think that's fundamentally been an issue around the way we provide support up to now through Common Agricultural Policy, and it's a fantastic opportunity through this bill to get that right.
Thank you. Ewan.
So I would actually argue that the objectives are complementary to one another rather than being in conflict. And we only have to look at recent events. Say if we take on-farm nature restoration as the starting point, if you have very resilient systems that can adapt to climate change and climate mitigation, then the effects of shock weather events, which are only going to become more frequent, like Storm Babet, are really, really curtailed to quite a large extent. And fundamentally, that means that not only is the food system safeguarded, but those rural communities who live there, who may or may not be within the agriculture industry, are also safeguarded.
Excuse me, David McCracken.
Thank you. And just two things with regard to Kate's question. As has already been said, all four objectives are strongly interrelated. Where there is a conflict, though, Kate, is the current definition of active farming puts a particular focus solely on food production. And so we've argued in our consultation response from SRUC that broadening out, not replacing food production as a definition of active farming, but broadening that out to also recognise that some element of environmental management, whether it's woodland creation, peatland restoration or habitat management, would also actually limit the perceived conflict there is from land managers at this point in time, that if they do environmental management, that's detracting from food production. The second thing was just to say that bear in mind that this is an agricultural rural communities bill, but the definition of rural communities within the framework of this bill is much narrower than rural communities per se out there. Farming and crofting, extraordinarily important part of the rural communities, but this bill per se doesn't address many of the wider challenges, whether it's education, transport, whatever, facing much more wider rural communities than just agriculture and crofting.
Just, I'm going to bring in Vicky, but just before then, can I actually, when you respond, also think about how the bill as it sits at the moment can deliver what I hear your aspirations are and what limitations there are. So we've heard a lot about definitions, whether that's sustainable or regenerative agriculture, definitions about rural communities, definitions about water quality, whatever. Where are those definitions to come? Should they be on the face of the bill, or should there be obligations to define them on the face of the bill? Does it come through secondary legislation? Can you maybe touch on that when you respond? So, Vicky and then Eleanor.
Thanks, Convener. I will come to that question of definitions, but just to say in terms of the objectives, as others have said, I think they are entirely complementary. If we think about high-quality food production, that depends on a healthy natural environment, on good soils, on pollinators, on clean water, and a stable climate in which to operate. Farmers can earn their living not just from that high-quality food production, but from the wide range of other goods and services that they provide, some of which can include that environmental management. So they are all interrelated and complementary. Are they enough? I think you've had evidence from others in previous sessions suggesting that we have a small set of high-level objectives, perhaps with some tweaking to what's there, but then a longer set of outcomes that we are looking for that policy to deliver. And that might be one way of better articulating some of what we want, because we had a number of other suggestions that could be included, for example, around maintaining high nature value farming and crofting systems in Scotland, for example. So that might be one way to do it. In terms of definitions, yes, I mean, they're really important, aren't they? And at the heart of all of this is about sustainable and regenerative agriculture. There's promise, and we'll probably come on to this, about a code of practice and setting that out. It's not clear within the bill what, in a sense, how binding that code of practice is. It's simply a requirement for that to be produced. I think that needs strengthening, because it seems to me that that code of practice should be something that's a condition, in a sense, on the payments that farmers receive in order for it to be binding and meaningful. But some of the content, as I think Kirsty alluded to before in terms of what we mean by this, can be set out in some of that code. But there will also need to be other things specified in the rural support plan, for example, around the intentions of the payments, who the beneficiaries are, what active farming is, and all those things, which don't necessarily need to be in this framework bill, but they will need to be in other places, or indeed in that secondary legislation, to set them out in much, much greater level of detail and clarity, which is effectively what we had with the Common Agricultural Policy. We had the main regulations, we had the implementing regulations, and we had the delegated acts, and we need that same kind of hierarchy of specificity in the legislation that we have for Scotland to replace the cap.
Thank you. Eleanor, then I'll go to another question from a member.
So I think, backing up what everyone's said already, but when we talk about these kind of many demands and slightly conflicting views on so the objective of the bill, perhaps, and the management of land, whether it's for food or community or the environment, most of the solutions tend to be the same. But what you're asking for is slightly different, and so much of this is down to how we explain it, that you can deliver many different benefits from single sort of changes of practice, and things like climate resilience and business resilience are one and the same. A lot of whether we're content with the objectives of the bill really depends on quite how the budget is split. So rural communities, when you look at Schedule 1, it's fairly clear what's sort of intended with it, but it's very broad. It includes things like infrastructure, ensuring people can live and work in rural areas, and it's great to see these things in the bill, but it's very different to what CAP is delivering for its majority of its purpose, including things like an integrated land management plan, which we've had no detail on really, other than potentially it being in the land reform bill. So there are clear links with this bill to other legislation that isn't really referenced within the explanatory notes or the policy memorandum, which it makes it difficult to fully scrutinise it because you don't have the detail yet. And that, so it does make our job much harder.
Okay, Rachel Hamilton.
On the reference to the CAP policies, the previous support mechanism, I wouldn't say personally that the outcomes supported farmers 100%, because if you look at what Davy McCracken was talking about with the flooding in the northeast, I mean, that's been replicated as we see changing climate across Scotland. And I just want to hone down on a bit more detail from David Harley from SEPA and David McCracken on some of these objectives, because I'm personally concerned that the facilitation of on-farm nature restoration, climate mitigation and adaptation is actually not going to support farmers to ensure that they can protect the food that they're growing, so their protein that they're growing on their land. And I wondered whether there should be more detail on the face of the bill. One, to ensure that farmers have the opportunity to work with organisations such as SEPA and others to ensure that they are part of that conversation, because so far it's very piecemeal. And two, where would that be added in the objectives if it was specifically around that catchment management approach? Can I start with David?
Yeah, thanks. I don't have a firm view about where that detail should be added, but absolutely I do think there should be more collaboration and facilitation of the right landscape scale, catchment scale intervention that delivers for multiple benefits, but crucially that must include climate change adaptation and flood prevention.
So specifically, on the face of the bill, an extra to that those objectives or within C?
again, I don't have a firm view about whether it's of huge value, whether it's specifically mentioned in the bill or not. Others may do, but I do think we need to have more collegiate support for the right interventions.
Okay, and David?
Oh, yeah, sorry, taking up time to, there was a delay in unmuting. Yes, I mean, the framework could be a bit more explicit on the need for that, and certainly the need for landscape scale interventions rather than just individual measures at an individual farm level. So it's implicit about that, but it could be more explicit. But actually, the framework still allows it. It will come in the secondary legislation, and particularly what measures and actions occur in each of the sort of the four tiers, but actually the sort of tiers two and tiers three is where those elements would actually be best suited. So it's having more detail on the range of measures and the how farmers, crofters can actually implement them that will actually help achieve them. And collaboration, cooperation, some level of the need for and a recognition of the need for that going forward. But that comes back to the questions you're no doubt going to come back to later about CPD, et cetera, et cetera.
I've got Ross McLeod one coming and then Ross Lilly.
Quickly, I don't think the words collaboration or landscape scale actually appear on the face of the bill, so I think it would be useful at least to define it in those terms somewhere in the bill to help clarify that collaborative approaches will be very useful going forward.
Just before bringing Ross in, so we hear about there should be in secondary legislation. Do we need to, in the face of the bill, actually set out that that needs to happen, or do we just expect it to happen in secondary legislation? We're all saying it needs to be here. We need to define it in secondary legislation, whether that's landscape, whether it's collaboration, whatever. Do we need to have a something on the face of the bill that forces the government, obliges the government to produce these things, or do we just let it happen?
Well, I think collaborative aspects are an important aspect which really need to be not necessarily defined, but at least mentioned on the face of the bill, yes.
Ross Lilly.
I think this goes back to the original point, including David McCracken's view about the definition of agriculture, because we're going to put a lot of store on this bill because 70% of our land is stewarded by farmers and crofters, but actually my original point about land being needed across the board to deliver a lot of outcomes beyond farming and crofting. So if you're looking at landscape scale in terms of an ecosystem approach, number one you would come up with would be flooding and catchment management. Absolutely, that's critical because it's such a dependency on a lot of society's needs, particularly downstream and urban areas and that sort of so on. But there are many other landscape scale ecosystem services that farmers take a part in that need to be recognised as well. I mean, woodland expansion was a big one. Peatland restoration, and it's not. But farmers are only part of the mix of that land use. And the question is, do we use the Agriculture Bill to facilitate that integrated land management at landscape scale, or what other mechanism have we got? And at the moment, it's not clear there is other mechanisms other than the Land Reform Bill, perhaps. But that we should perhaps point out to the farming industry that they have a major part to play, and this is how they can be part of that.
Thank you. Vicky Swales.
I think a specific suggestion, convener, for all those things, both for collaborative and landscape scale and for dealing with flood management, flood risk and appropriate land management, seems to me would be in Schedule 1, because that's setting out a long list of the purposes for which support can be given. There isn't anything specifically, certainly on the collaborative stuff within those, from a very quick skim through there, but additions there would be the place, I think, because that then opens up the potential for the rural support plan and all the various measures to do those things.
Thank you. Eleanor?
Just a quick one. I had a similar skim through to Vicky, and there are, and I've noted a few that, you know, part five has plants and soil. There's nothing in there about water holding capacity or biological activity in there. There are loads of there are a number of sort of sensible tweaks that could be made to Schedule 1, which I don't think would cause too many headaches for government at all.
Okay, thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. Obviously, as others have alluded to, we're kind of talking about half the picture here. We're talking about the primary legislation, but obviously there's secondary legislation to come, which will fill out much of the detail. But I suppose one of the issues I'm interested in is how progress against these objectives can actually be measured, in your view, and what either primary or secondary legislation could do to help achieve that and ensure that we evaluate our progress against these objectives.
I'd like to do that, Vicky.
Thanks, Convener. Well, I think it's absolutely vital that there are requirements set out which require the government to undertake effective monitoring and evaluation of the public money that it's spending and the outcomes that it does achieve under the framework. It needs to set out its intentions in that rural support plan very clearly as to what it's trying to do and against the objectives in this bill, and if we then have a longer list of outcomes we want to achieve, it needs to be required to do that monitoring and evaluation. And I would argue it needs to come back and report on that to Parliament some way midway between the midpoint of that rural support plan, which was talking about a five-year period, for example. So it would be good to have a kind of health check in the middle, and then at the end of that five-year period, that plan would be reviewed, it would be reported on, and the plan would be revised and then amended and go forward again for the next 5 years. So there's a kind of cycle there, which again, if we're keeping aligned with the EU, mirrors somewhat what was in the CAP in terms of those monitoring and evaluation and reporting requirements.
So you think there should be an obligation on the face of the bill for that monitoring to take place?
I think it's not explicit at the minute. There are some aspects within the bill which do require the government to do that, but I don't think it's explicitly set out in that way at the moment.
Thank you. Dave?
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, this comes back a little bit to the fact that is, you know, framework bill, and so it's quite hard, you know, you kind of expect these things. So the analogy for me is the just transition outcomes and how we're struggling with monitoring and evaluation for those. And I think it would be great for this bill to kind of have a think about what metrics the government thinks it will apply and actually have that critical pathway analysis to say, do they have the granularity? Can farmers provide those data? Or, you know, do they already exist? So actually having a think about that M&E side of things in quite some depth before they get to the secondary legislation, because it's so fundamental, and it's got that potential to either mean we're still here in 10 years' time going, well, did we improve soil health? Did we mitigate climate and increase resilience? Did we enable rural communities to thrive? And, you know, the clock is ticking, as we all know, and that's my main issue with this is we all hope it will deliver everything that's required, but it doesn't articulate that in a way where we can say for certain it will.
Kirsty, did you come in?
Yeah, I mean, it's quite hard to know where this will sit, but I think progress we have to measure. We won't know if we have progress if we don't measure. I don't know where quite in the bill where we can be more explicit about that, but I think it does need to be explicit. I think I'd just like to make a point that when we're looking at how we measure and we're looking at how we design these tools and the data and the information, it has to be a really fair system of implementation, measurement and achievement, which empowers farmers, crofters and growers and acknowledges their knowledge. But it has to be a trusted and accessible and easy to understand and use. The pressure for this isn't just coming from public funding. You know, it's not just coming from this bill. It's coming from private funding. And I think we can't really talk about this without acknowledging the private funding that's coming down the line. And I think this is a huge opportunity at this point in time to really try and get an understanding of this and try and make it a fair and equal system for farmers and crofters and growers to actually work within and give them the tools and the opportunities that they can do these things and achieve these things. And if we don't, we risk the disillusionment, turning away from change. So I think this is a really important time, and it has to happen now. We know it has to happen now. 2030 is not that far away. So I think this is a really good opportunity to try and understand the whole, as we say, ecosystem of all of these measures and how we do it.
Just on that, you touched on viability, whatever. Should one of the objectives not be that we need to have viable, profitable agriculture? Because there's an often coined phrase, you can't be in the green if you're in the red. So should that be an objective on the bill, that we actually need to ensure that we have viable and profitable agriculture?
So, having worked for NFFN, I think we would disagree with that statement. You know, we see if you don't work with nature, if you don't integrate nature into your systems, you aren't going to be viable. You know, this is fundamental to farming and crofting. And that is a bit of a mindset change. We don't see working, farming with nature or crofting with nature, we see it as profitable. You might want to come in here to talk about maximum sustainable output, but there, you know, it isn't. I think that is something that we have to work through, and we have to communicate, and we have to make this easy for farmers and crofters to engage in. But Ewan, do you want to come in from NFFN's point of view?
Yep, definitely. So I would point the committee towards NFFN's work on maximum sustainable output. We've got a host of reports, Less is More, Nature Means Business. And it's all fundamentally about this idea of maximum sustainable output, where farms need to be operating within the carrying capacity of the land. And the idea of maximum sustainable output is there comes a tipping point where farms' productive variable costs become corrective variable costs. And often that's pushed upon farmers and crofters who have, you know, a whole host of advisors seeking to, you know, whether it's sell them products or acting in their own best interest. But there needs to be a sweet spot for farming where the inputs are lowered so that soil health can be regenerated. And it does take a little bit of time, and we would like to see agreements that have a bit of time attached to them so the carrying capacity of the land can recover, so soil health can recover, and sustainable output sort of flourishes.
Yeah, I've got five people have indicated they want to come in, but I'm going to bring in Jim Fairley because I think he's got a supplementary on Kirsty's comments.
I'm going to throw a spanner in the works here, and I do apologise beforehand. But I absolutely get the need for us to have this collaboration, working with nature and all the rest of it. But it comes right back to Kate's question right at the start, where do you see conflicts? And those conflicts absolutely exist. I very recently had a visit to an arable farm where the flood banks have been undermined by beavers. The flood banks have blown out, and you've now got 30 acres of arable land that was organic now sitting with silt lying over the top of it, and it's going to cost hundreds of thousands of pounds to reinstate those flood banks. So those kinds of conflicts have to be accepted and worked out how we're going to get round those compromises. So it's all very well us sitting here and round this table saying, yeah, we'll come to solutions. But right now, if you're going to take farmers with you, the farmers who are being affected by this are not listening, because all they're seeing is huge acres of their land going underwater and under silt.
Can we just back that up from the agritourism businesses in the session, on the consultation? They actually quoted, this is a quote, "Without a profitable farming enterprise producing food, it is challenging to undertake these restoration and adaptation measures." So it's just to back that statement up by witnesses.
OK, thank you. I'm going to bring in David McCracken, Elnor, Ross Lilly, and then Ross McLeod.
Thanks, Convener. The point's already been made, I think, about the importance of monitoring and measuring been much more explicit in the bill itself. I just wanted to point out, also going back to Alistair's question, monitoring and measuring is not just important for knowing whether the outcomes are actually being achieved. Monitoring and measuring are going to be fundamental in most instances for farmers and crofters to know what elements of their farming systems is best, their best place to actually achieve change and achieve those outcomes in the sort of the first instance. I also just wanted to emphasise that there needs to be a focus on monitoring and measurement within the bill and the secondary legislation that flows from this. But Eleanor's already mentioned earlier on, this is not the only game in town as far as policy, the policy landscape that we're actually dealing with. So the Natural Environment Bill, the Biodiversity Strategy, it's associated with that, Just Transition, the Climate Change Plan. There's a whole host of other policies and procedures out there that will also be requiring some level of monitoring and measuring of what's happening on our agricultural land, because, as has already been said, 70% of Scotland is agricultural land. So there needs to be much more join up between the outcomes being desired from the bill and the associated secondary legislation, and the different types of monitoring and measuring approaches that will be associated with both this bill and other aspects of Scottish policy going forward.
Eleanor.
Yeah, and thanks for the support, David. I think so much of this is about, you know, data is only useful if we analyse it, and we can't just collect it for the sake of it. There is obviously a section in the bill on checking, enforcing and monitoring, but it seems mainly about enforcing rules and potential penalties if it's not followed. It doesn't seem to be about collecting that data and then giving it back to farmers in a way that they can use it. And potentially that's where we get things in Tier 4, but we collect an awful lot of data already, and it's often not analysed, or it sits behind a wall that we can't really access as land managers, and yet could hold some very useful information for us. So whilst there was quite a big section on this in the 2022 consultation, I'm not really seeing that in the bill, and whether that's because it's intended for secondary legislation is perhaps the reason. But we know an awful lot of data is going to be required to know if we're making the right changes, if the changes we're thinking about are remotely suitable for our systems. We know Tier 2 is going to be an incredibly long list of options. Now, you can only make strategic decisions if you have some kind of information about your system, about your soils, and so many other things within the wider landscape that your holding sits. Data is really important in this, and we probably need more of it on the face of the bill.
Thank you. Ross Lilly.
So can I make 2 points, one about the data monitoring and come back to the point about conflicts and how we facilitate that. So in terms of data, I mean, to add to what's been said, there's a huge market out there. And I've seen market in the broadest sense of the term. It's not just food and fibre markets and supply chains, but that finance institutions that are stacking up, ready to invest in land, and particularly farmland, for not just for carbon, but nature. There's a nature market there, desperate to invest, but they are not confident, nor is the land manager, the farmer, confident to engage in it, because there's a common thread behind it, and that's confidence in the data and the metrics that everybody's using to trade on, and confidence in terms of the underpinning platform in which government provides the basis to trade on as well. And I think there's a role for government to provide that, and desperate for the market's desperately asking government to provide standard, publicly accountable metrics so they can trade fairly on it. Otherwise, market's trying to come up with their own, and it's all over the place, and farmers are having to try and work out which particular metric they're having to meet in order to deliver a particular supply chain. So there's a role there for the bill to help provide that base set of data everybody can understand, is neutral, it's in the public interest, it's not traded as well, because there's a big issue about trading data. Back to the other point about conflicts and beavers and so on. I mean, part of the answer to that is that it's a wicked problem, and Nature Scots trying to help farmers deal with issues like that. A lot of the solution is in this back to this landscape scale approach and collaboration, and the more support we can put that way, the more we can and go through an integrated land managing approach, the more we can articulate the primacy of land use for specific purposes. So there's land that we should absolutely protect for the primacy of food production, because it's good for that's what the soil is good for, but there's also land that we should say is primacy for nature and make space for nature. And a lot of these conflict issues is because we haven't sorted that out. And we need to provide facility for a particular collaborative group of land managers, of which farmers are probably the largest part of, in a landscape scale, to work that out so that we can then allocate that land accordingly.
Just before we move on, both Kirsten and yourself have touched on private investment. The bill is void of any information relating to that, whether it's biodiversity net gain, whether it's carbon credits. Is that something that should be, or do we need something in the face of the bill that refers to other pieces of legislation, so biodiversity plans, the climate change plan, but the private investment side of it is something that's not anywhere in the bill as it stands just now?
So it's quite a blunt tool. It's just looking at public money, quite a big chunk of public money. And the danger is that
because we want to audit that and make sure we're getting value for money, that we actually either risk crowding out the opportunities that markets provide. So at the bare minimum, the bill should set out how it facilitates farmers accessing those markets alongside the public and money they get. That's crucial. Yeah.
Thanks. I'm going to bring in Ross McLeod and then Vicky.
Thank you, Convener. It was really just to echo the point that Ross is making about this clarity in how we conduct both public funding support and private funding support. At the moment, there is a huge amount of energy, a lot of heat in the private sector building up to try and define how we deliver that, but not a lot of light in terms of the way we measure. So I think it is incumbent on government to provide some clarity, at least on the governance and the framework. I know it set out the interim rules on sensible investment in natural capital, but I think we need to go a bit further than that now, because in the urgency to make sure that farmers can deliver, there is this need for confidence and clarity. The other points I think to make about the private funding side is that it will probably work best at scale, because it will deliver economies of investment that way. So again, it links back to the necessity for some collaborative aspect to be built into the bill, which will link with that. In terms of conflicts, I made the point earlier that we need some flexibility, because we're in a huge learning curve here, and we may find that the evidence suggests in certain places that we're not being successful, in other places we are. And I think the only way we're going to resolve some of the conflicts is by having that flexibility to understand, interpret, and go back to the drawing board, if you like, on certain occasions to revisit the measures that we apply. There are, at the moment, some significant evidence gaps for a start, so we need that flexibility.
Vicky.
Yeah, on the question about the public-private, I mean, I think we do have to be careful, don't we, of not trying to weigh in everything into this bill. At the end of the day, this is a bill trying to create powers, to give ministers powers to spend that £700 million thereabouts of public money. Clearly what we need to be alive to is not doing things in this that closes off avenues to some of that private finance, because we know that the scale of need is enormous to deliver for nature and climate. We will need that private finance in place. There's clearly other pieces of policy and legislation dealing with some of that. It's important that that private market is regulated and it's doing good things, not necessarily creating more problems. But I don't necessarily think all of that needs to be in the face of this bill. I did just also want to touch on the conflicts issue, and particularly there's often reference to certain species, but also just to point out that there's already significant investment taking place through NatureScot and through various species management schemes which support farmers and crofters to deal with some of these issues where they occur. There are also other recourses to action which can be done in some cases for some species in terms of legal control, and that is available to farmers. But I absolutely take the point that once we sort of step back and start to look at this from a bigger landscape or catchment perspective, then we can put some of the solutions in place. So many of the issues around flooding, Jim, are, as you well know, are obviously getting worse with climate change. But even before species such as beavers were reintroduced to Scotland, we had significant problems of flood banks degrading in extreme weather events. And we've got problems of some of those sections of rivers have been canalised, creating further problems, and we're not allowing rivers to flow in a more natural way. But some of that nature restoration can actually do some of that, creating habitat for the beavers, and the beavers can help create that, but also in making sure that we then protect that other agricultural land where we need to produce food. So I think there are more integrated solutions here, and there are definitely options on the table for farmers and crofters in this space already.
Okay. David Harley.
Yeah, I fully agree with the points made already about monitoring and evaluation being a requirement. And we know that some of the key metrics around nature restoration and water quality and the potential for climate change mitigation are not being met under the status quo. So that's a starting point. The point about conflict, absolutely right now, under the status quo, there are flashpoints of conflict around flooding, around river management, and there's going to be increasing risk of that around water scarcity. So absolutely, but that's under the status quo. If we don't change to a more landscape scale, collaborative, facilitated approach, that will exacerbate as climate change impacts worsen. So I think there's huge potential here to do something about those conflict areas through this bill.
Thank you. David McCracken.
Thanks, Convener. I just come back to your original question. I accept and agree with what Vicky's saying about, you know, there's only so much that can be put into this bill with regard to private investment, private finance. But nevertheless, going back to your original question, the fact that the framework is completely silent on the recognition that some large level of private external investment is going to be required in order to meet our net zero targets means that the bill doesn't seem to recognise that it needs to actually at least make provision for those type of investments being available to farmers and crofters, and needs to make provision to actually how would the bill and the secondary legislation actually ensure that it aligns with that properly. And not doing that means that there is a high degree of likelihood that we're going to see some unintended consequences going forward with farmers either choosing to take up some form of a private investment that may then preclude them continuing to get some form of public funding support, or being caught betwixt and between, not knowing which way to actually jump. So it is beholden on the framework of the secondary legislation to make the link how the secondary legislation will align and ensure that it actually takes into account that such private investment opportunities will, by dint of their nature, increase in the future and make that landscape much more easier for farmers and crofters to negotiate in the future.
Okay, thank you. I've got two people who want to come in, but I'm very conscious we haven't heard from our three colleagues. So can I ask you to come and give your comments and also on the thoughts about the three objectives that we've got and whether we need to have more? So I'll ask Alistair first and then Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. I want to pick up on two points. First, around monitoring and conflict. So, absolutely, monitoring has got to be key here. But I just want to flag that there's an awful lot of other legislation coming down the line where monitoring and evaluation is also going to be a significant requirement. So, can we be clever and smart about this and not develop a strategy for this bill and then find that our colleagues somewhere else have developed another strategy? Private markets are looking for that. It's going to be important in the environment bill. It's going to be important for the monitoring of our fisheries, for our water quality, for our invasive non-native species. So let's think about this beyond the realms of this bill and let's be really clever and smart. There are also some really exciting opportunities coming down the line in terms of technology development. We're finding ways in our sector to reduce the cost of monitoring using drone surveying, using artificial intelligence. So let's be thinking ahead and future-proofing the technologies that we're using here. And let's be really smart about this. In terms of conflicts, yes, I think we need to be honest that conflicts are there and do exist, but there are a number of fantastic examples where there's real synergy here. And in our world of trees and woods on farms, we've spent the best part of a decade working with crofters and farmers looking at really clever ways of integrating trees into farming landscapes that can give you benefits for nature, benefits for carbon, but crucially benefits for farmers and crofters and for farm management and for farm operations and farm productivity. And last year, we were able to publish this lovely little short document with support from NFU Scotland and the Crofting Federation that outlines some of the kind of the science behind that, but also gives some really wonderful creative examples of how that's already being demonstrated by farmers and crofters across Scotland. I've got five colleagues working purely with the crofting audience. We've got a long waiting list of crofters who can see how this can really support what they're doing. So conflicts do exist, but there's real opportunity for synergy here as well. I am not going to answer your question around the four objectives. To me, they look broad enough and capable enough. I would agree that I think outcomes are what it's all about. And I think if we can be really smart and clear about what we're trying to deliver beneath those outcomes, that for me is where we're going to get this right or wrong.
Thank you. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, just a quick comment on the point about monitoring and metrics. I think it's incredibly important. We've talked about leveraging private funding into the forestry and rural sector more generally. And there are significant opportunities through modern forestry of all types. But the thing that we lack, we've got good evidence on carbon benefit, but the thing that we lack is good evidence and good metrics on biodiversity benefit. And one of the things I often say is there isn't a lack of biodiversity in modern productive forestry, there's just a lack of measurement of the biodiversity in that forestry. And as a result, it's seen as a negative, and there's no recognition of the positives that sit within it. In terms of doing another objective on the bill, it's actually a tricky one for forestry people to get their heads around, because in the 2018 forestry legislation, there's a requirement to establish, to agree a Scottish forestry strategy, and that's been the primary mechanism to be saying, what do we want to do with our forests? What do we want to do with the new woodlands that we create? So, whereas in terms of the bill and the funding, the principle of being able to look at those different land uses and the funding mechanisms available and providing opportunities for those to be joined up is an attractive proposition in principle, though I would say after yesterday's brutal announcement on slashing the forestry planting budget, I'm questioning that in my mind. But there is a challenge there of, if we put something into this bill, does then that cut across the provision in the forestry bill and relate to the Scottish forestry strategy? So I think at this point we're probably err on the side of saying best not to say something specific on forestry, because they could have those unintended consequences.
Okay, thank you. Finally, on this theme, I'm going to bring in Dave and then Kirsten and then move on.
Really, just around that private finance question, and this, I've got it highlighted on my screen, is the enabling rural communities to thrive, because that for me is a crucial one. And that is something where it's unintended consequences has been brought up a few times. And I kind of think, say the government decide to stick with those four objectives, then I think they really need to articulate that they've done the work at that primary level of these are the contexts. And so private investment is a really good example where that could undermine the enabling rural communities to thrive in terms of land prices are, you know, really high, and that's potentially going to undermine it, depending on how it works and how it's regulated in terms of that deliverable. So something which, going, basically the point is that should be acknowledged that the private sector, that investment is a huge opportunity, but there are also risks to the outcomes that should be articulated in this bill.
You, Kirsty.
Just to come in, I'm going back to equipping farmers and crofters to engage in this system.
And bringing it back to the bill, I think the really fundamental piece is going to be in knowledge and information and education, because we're asking farmers and crofters and growers to be carbon literate. We're also asking them to be biodiversity, natural capital, eco-services literate. Integrating what is an incredibly demanding high skill, high knowledge profession. And I think at the moment we are not preparing them, we're not putting enough budget into that, which is the continuous professional development, but also the education system. And Davey will know more, can talk more about that. But I think this is going to be fundamental in the transition period to actually upskill and give our farmers and crofters the ability to be able to rise to this challenge and work within this system that we want them to work in. And at the moment, there's a fundamental knowledge gap and skills gap, and we're not being fair to them. Even just understanding the financial landscape at the moment, and even just getting a definition of terms would be really good and getting out there. But I think it's not performing in the way it should be at the moment.
Thank you. We're certainly going to move on to look at CPD in more detail towards the end of the session. We're now going to move on to theme two, which surrounds the Code of Practice for Sustainable Regenerative Agriculture. And question from Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. We've had differing evidence, I guess, from different stakeholders about whether the Code of Practice and the definition of sustainable and regenerative agriculture should be on the face of the bill, or whether it is right that it comes under guidance. And if people are content that it's right that it comes under guidance, is Section 7 right, or does that need to be tightened up for more scrutiny?
Ross Lilley.
I think the approach, taking a code of good practice, is a good one, because I think, judging by your previous evidence you've had, we're all agreed that being too prescriptive about what regenerative agriculture is a bad move, as it were, in terms of a lot of it absolutely depends on the farmer and the crofter interpreting what regenerative agriculture is in their own context.
So the code of practice provides a basis of explaining what we're trying to achieve on an outcome-based approach using principles and so on. So that's my understanding, and that's what the bill intends to do. So if we agree with that, then, and we get that right, then it needs to be better linked to the support framework. It can't just be there as just as an advisory thing. In the way that's currently, just to give an example, one of the good agriculture environmental conditions around soils relies on the claimant abiding by the Muirburn Code, and it works the very same way. So they have to show that they're meeting the Muirburn Code in order to demonstrate that they're meeting that condition.
Ross McLeod.
Thank you. I'm unsure how much prescription we have to put into the bill as far as code of practice is concerned, but I can refer to our experience dealing with the Wildlife Management and Muirburn Bill, which requires various codes to be put into place. Now, some of that refers to licensing, which is obviously legal in its requirement. Beyond that, there is moorland management best practice, where we're looking at various guidance for moorland managers, which operates across, obviously, gamekeepers, but also farmers and crofters too. Within that, we're looking to define a code of practice, which clearly identifies the legal musts, but also defines coulds and shoulds. And within each of those categories of coulds and should, we're trying to define verifiable evidence that could be used to demonstrate performance of could and should. And it strikes me that that is quite a good model for the way in which the code of practice for agriculture could work, particularly as we learn, as we progress, that there's a flexibility there to adjust the guidance in terms of the verifiable evidence going forward.
Eleanor.
Really following on from Ross. We support the intention of the code. We'd quite like some assurances on that there is industry involvement in this. We think there does need to be a sort of academic or R&D sort of sense check of the code and quite what it intends to deliver. And it also needs to have a sort of clear sector link, which we're not really seeing, and an actual plan of how we communicate the intention of the code to the sector. There is no point having a code of practice once we finally decide the definitions of sustainable and regenerative agriculture if it is not communicated to the sector as to what that actually means. We do have some concerns about the guidance section and largely the negative procedure linked to the guidance section, and the fact that it seems to be much more to do with kind of creating a potential kind of obligation as to quite how well you followed it, quite what it means. We already have an issue with how guidance is applied to certain parts of the sector, and when it comes to things like inspections, guidance is very open for interpretation. This is our one chance to really address the vagueness of things like guidance. And if the code of practice is going to be so important, we need to be really clear on quite what it means for the sector.
So just on that, so what should the oversight be of the code of practice? Because ultimately it could be very important when it comes to cross-compliance, payments and whatever down the road. So what level of scrutiny should that code of practice come under? In your contribution to the committee, you suggested that the plan should have oversight, and that oversight shouldn't be ARIOB. You didn't say why it shouldn't be ARIOB, but you said it shouldn't be. Do you think the code of practice should come under the same sort of scrutiny with an oversight body or whatever looking at scrutiny, given the potential for it to form the basis of cross-compliance for any other payments?
Yeah, definitely. I think that the fact that it's going to have such importance means I just have an issue with the ARIOB membership and the general terms of reference. I don't think it's fit for purpose. It doesn't really represent, it doesn't really have the farmer representation anymore. I think we do have to question that, but that's sort of an aside. But the fact that it just doesn't seem to have enough consultation built into the drafting of it. And I'm not sure there's enough assessment of it as it once it's been published for us to be able to go back with a feedback mechanism to say, actually, this isn't working. We have it with reintroduced species, that we see issues in how the
how the system is supposed to be in place to provide support if there is conflict. We don't have feedback mechanisms when things crop up that you weren't expecting, that no one could have expected. We do not have a rapid feedback mechanism to quickly address these issues. Instead, we say we're going to have to review this, and we don't have a date for an actual review. So the code of practice needs to be far tighter on when it's reviewed, how it's supported and advised by both the sector and by academics, and how we ensure it's fit for purpose in a sort of ongoing basis, be that quarterly meetings or something. An ARD, which we had regular meetings with, would have been a subgroup of that, would have been a sensible way to go. So there are things we can do.
Thank you. Bringing Ross McLeod in back to Rhoda Grant.
I'd agree with Eleanor that possibly through ARD, which unfortunately we haven't met in recent months, but it would be a useful conduit to underpin a review of the code of practice. I think that would be a sensible way forward.
OK, thank you. Rhoda.
Just on that, should those regulations be on the face of the bill, or is it OK, as the bill stands at the moment, that the regulations can be brought by subordinate legislation to the Parliament as to how you devise the code of practice? Or should both the regulations and the code of practice come on front of the Parliament? Should there be a... Sorry, I'm not putting this very clearly, but should the mechanism for drawing up a code of practice be on the face of the bill, or is it OK by regulation? And the subsequent code of practice, should that be subject to greater scrutiny by the Parliament, because we don't know that if the regulations have yet to be devised?
I want to come to that
it's
point.
It's a really good question. I think the more you sort of read the bill, and you know, well, I've probably read it a number of times, it is so clear this code of practice is ingrained in every piece of secondary legislation that is going to come forward. So I think it is right to question whether it does need to be, you know, in much more detail on the face of the bill. And I would agree, it probably does need to be far clearer and on the bill.
Vicky Swales.
Absolutely, it's clear the government's hanging its vision on this around sustainable and regenerative agriculture, so it needs to be defined. The code is the place for that. But as it's set out in the bill, it is literally just that code has to be produced and to be brought forward, and that will be dealt with through secondary legislation. So it's not binding on ministers, it's not binding on farmers, and it has no traction. So I think absolutely it needs to be strengthened. There needs to be scrutiny of the code by appropriate bodies, possibly by Parliament, but certainly by an expert overview of it as to whether it's appropriate. I think government should be required to set out in its rural support plan, amongst many other things, we'll come on to that, about the content of that, but referring back to that code and saying this is how we're going to effectively enact this and deliver sustainable and regenerative agriculture in Scotland. Absolutely, it's not binding, but it needs to be. It's too vague and open at the moment.
Ross Lilly, and then Ross McLeod.
I'm trying to think, it's quite a technical thing. It does require a shared approach. Farmers absolutely have to be involved in it, because they're going to have to deliver it. So in the governance, they need to be involved and represented in terms of making decisions over how it's implemented. Because the danger is if it becomes a core requirement of the bill and it therefore delivered through the delivery mechanism of the schemes through our ARPED colleagues, for instance, and it becomes an inspection thing, then it gets funneled down into the risk-averse approach, that you know, a desire to define it so that it can be inspected on and verified, when actually it can only work by a shared risk approach in terms of understanding about how it works in different circumstances. So if I'm not really answering the question, but I suppose if the need to have a code and for it to be properly governed absolutely should be part of the bill. But the management of it and the scrutiny of it and the revision of it perhaps is something that should become in secondary, and the Parliament needs to know there's a good mechanism, a democratic mechanism for doing that.
Thank you. Vicky.
Sorry, I meant to say, convener, I certainly agree with what Ross has just said in terms of actually drafting of it. There needs to be an inclusive process to do that. But also, I think government will need to, in that process, to clearly cross-reference, as has been mentioned, to a range of other codes, actually, which apply. So we have the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement, there's talk of a Land Reform Bill, and making that more of a code and more binding. We've got the Wildlife Management Mewburn Bill and the Code of Practice coming forward. So we need to make sure that these things are not contradictory and there's also alignment across the piece as well on some things.
Thank you. Ross McLeod.
Well, really recognising the differences between voluntary and statutory codes, I do wonder whether the Wildlife Management Bill might provide some hints about the way in which Code of Practice could be developed. It might be worth referring to that for assessment.
Okay. Thank you. I think this is probably an appropriate time to stop for a quick comfort break. We'll reconvene at 10:25. Thank you. reconvene, and we're going to move to our third theme for this morning, which is looking at the rural support plan. And I'll go to Rachel Hamilton for the first question.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to combine a number of questions so that all the panellists can either pick or choose which one they ask answer. But first of all, when would you like to see a draft rural support plan? Secondly, should there be a statutory requirement to consult on a rural support plan? And with the painful news of the budget in terms of the agricultural cuts yesterday, do you feel confident that the rural support plan will be accompanied by the resources needed to achieve the four objectives that we discussed earlier? And what role do you think Parliament have in terms of the scrutiny of the plan? And finally, which areas do you believe ministers should have regard to when producing the rural support plan?
Go to Vicky Swales first.
Thanks, Convener. And I'll try and be brief because I've got answers to all those questions, Rachel. But when, the sooner the better. But I think officials said to you in giving evidence, they talked about 2025. It certainly needs to be in place before secondary legislation is passed. And we need to see very clearly the content of that plan, its intentions and what it's going to set out. Should there be a statutory requirement to consult? Yes, there should. I think it's particularly important that there's wide input to that plan and setting out what it's going to do and how that four-tier framework is going to operate and how the money is going to be spent. The budget, that's a major question, isn't it? Is there enough money in the pot to do everything we need to? Probably not. We know this is a UK government decision and that there's only money for the life of the current UK Parliament, and decisions will be taken after a general election with potentially a new government. A piece of work RSPB was involved in identified that Scotland's share of a future budget, so the overall UK budget for farm support, needs to increase given the scale of need, particularly the scale of need to tackle nature and climate and support farmers and underpin our food production. It needs to go from the current figure of about 3.7 to 4.4, and Scotland's share of that should increase. So up to about 1.17 billion was the estimate we came up with. There's a second question, which I won't answer now, about how that money should be deployed across the tiers. I think there's a really important question about how government spends that money, whatever the quantum it gets from the UK government, compared to now, and I think it needs to change significantly. In terms of scrutinising the plan, absolutely. I don't think it's enough for it just to be laid before Parliament. I think it needs to be laid, put before Parliament for a specified number of sitting days to allow parliamentary scrutiny and debate on that. I think we'd also add into that that there should be, as I mentioned earlier, a sort of review point for it to come back to Parliament midway between in that five-year period to see how progress, some kind of report on progress of how things are going. And I'm sorry, your final point was, I think, about how making it binding on ministers. Was that right, Rachel?
Should the RSP have regard to which other plans, cross-sectional legislation?
Yes, absolutely. So when we get into thinking about the content and things, there's a whole raft of other plans and strategies and things that ministers will need to take into account, including the biodiversity strategy, the existing climate plan, climate targets, lots of other things that will need to be taken into consideration. Thank you.
McCracken.
Yep, thank you. Yeah, I agree with all of what Vicky said there. Just to actually highlight that one of the rationale, the primary rationale for having a rural support plan is also to provide some stability going forward in terms of for farmers and crofters to know what is going to happen over the four or five, whatever length of time the actual plan is going to be actually active for. And so that is another reason why it's essential that that comes forward sooner rather than later, and not just to inform the secondary legislation, but just to be sure that farmers know what is actually happening, particularly with regard to the budget. I'm surprised we're 1.5 hours into the actual session and we haven't addressed the elephant in the room in terms of the distribution of the budget across the sort of four tiers, how that budget is going to be distributed initially and how that distribution may change during the period of the lifetime of the first plan. will be essential if we're going to know and for Parliament to scrutinise, to know whether we're going to stand any chance of meeting actually the outcomes that the framework bill has at all. So scrutiny is essential. The draft's needed sooner rather than later. In fact, we should have had it well before now, sort of thing, in terms of the sort of the framework. If you look to the similar situation within Europe, their sort of strategic planning process does lay out all these sort of details about the intervention logic, the projected budgets, etc., etc., etc. Without that, we really do need that in Scotland, so as that we actually have a real big in stuck in the map, so as we know how to actually then consider and address every other element of both these policies and related policies, to know whether we're going to stand any chance whatsoever of ensuring that farmers and crofters can move forward the way Scottish Government has an aspiration to do so.
Thank you. Eleanor.
So, really just echoing what Vicky and Davey have already said, so agree, the sooner the better for this plan to arrive, and 2025 feels arguably too long to wait. Do you have to question why we couldn't have perhaps had it already, as it's at least in a draft version? There needs to be meaningful consultation on this, lengthy consultation, not just not just a 12-week written one. We do need to sort of get out and see people about this. And we really want to see, much like with the Code of Practice, that there is academic advisory oversight in some form and a link to a sort of sector steering group in whatever way that is sort of wanted by the wider sector. It's absolutely right that Parliament has the length of time to scrutinise this that's required, and to scrutinise that the process has been followed to sort of gather the views of the sector. And completely agree with Vicky that this needs to have a sort of a feedback loop of some kind that allows sort of regular review. We know there obviously is a trigger that if something needs to be changed, there's a sort of set of criteria that can be, if they're met, then obviously the plan can be changed, but perhaps that needs to be slightly broader. Yes, I agree that there needs to be sort of budgetary consideration in this. How achievable it is will depend on the finance available. And again, we saw that very long list in the agricultural reform route map of the interrelated policies that will fit in with agriculture. It's really important that this support plan includes reference to biodiversity, the land use strategy. I won't go through them all, but there's no mention of the Good Food Nation Act, secondary legislation, for instance. But we know there are many policies that will absolutely interact with this area.
Dave Ray.
Thank you. Yeah, without repeating what all the good things that have been said, timing yesterday would have been good. So one of the things is as soon as possible. I guess it is somewhat contingent, or it's got to integrate with the climate change plan next year, and for the just transition plan for the sector, which should also, certainly the draft, be out next year. So it needs that articulation. The other thing on budget, so I just wanted to echo Vicky, really, is when we think about what our sector, so agriculture and land use, has to do for the UK net zero target, we've got some seriously heavy lifting to do. There's a lot of reliance on us. So that those budget numbers you're talking about, Vicky, there is a disproportionate pressure on us to deliver, and so that needs to translate into funding.
Kirsty.
I think just backing up Dave there, and maybe it's a different, looking at this budget in a different kind of way in the allocation, this is a just transition, this is a transition. In order to enable that just transition to happen, we would hope this is a time period transition. So we really need the budget. I mean, FSCC supports RSPB in that call for that budget, that amount of budget from a UK level. And we need it for a period of time. Things will change hugely over the next 5 years. And I think it's sensible to front-load and to give the enough budget to make these things start to happen. But it is going to be integral, I think.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to a question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow up on a question there in regards to what needs to be taken into consideration. We've heard there's a few acts that you feel should be considered when we're looking at this, but at the same time we have that issue where we want this as soon as possible. We're being asked for that. So do you think there are, like, asking for opinions from yourself, what specifically do you think should be taken into consideration? What acts might you want to be taken into consideration? And are you willing for that time to lapse?
Ewan, and then Ross Lilly.
Having recently responded to the biodiversity strategy framework for the Natural Environment Bill, that is going to have significant impact on the Agriculture Bill. There are specific clauses and actions within the consultation that highlight, I believe one of them is that 50% of farm funding will be moved to conditional payments by 2030, which the NFFN would be very supportive of. It was one of our asks to move money out of Tier 1, but it has to be highlighted within this bill because it has really big significance. I would point the committee towards the recent Wales Agriculture Act. I think they were quite impressive, particularly with their objectives in how they interlaid and referenced to other acts that, you know, predated or were coming. And that really roots ministers in their decision making. For example, with theirs, it was all about meeting the needs of future generations. So things like that, with reference to the Natural Environment Bill, the Good Food Nation Plan, they can really shore up future decisions, giving ministers confidence to deliver on those things, as well as constituents, farmers and crofters, to know that they are going to be safeguarded in those future decisions.
Move to Ross.
Thank you, Convener.
Sorry, I beg your pardon. Ross Lilly and...
Oh, sorry. Just...
Three Rosses here, which, I thought the Daves were going to be confusing. We've got three Davids, Daves, and Ross and...
That's why you're separating us out. Just to answer your specific question, I mean, there's a couple of key pieces of legislation coming through. The proposed Natural Environment Bill will set out targets for biodiversity in particular, and as well as wider environment targets. So the plan has to take account of those, and there's a timing issue there. We're kind of almost second-guessing what they might be and what we're going to put into the Agriculture Bill. And then the Climate Change Plan as well, which is probably the key one. It's been refreshed and reviewed, so it needs to take into those. Those are the two, in terms of the biodiversity climate, and obviously there's the Good Food Nation plan too.
I'll give you an idea. So matters that should be considered within the bill, some of the written evidence and also the verbal, this is a list. I'll not go through it all. Good Food Nation, Crofter Law Reform, Wider Consideration for Crofters and Common Grazing, Biodiversity Strategy, Climate Change Plan, River Basin Management Plan, Scottish Nitrogen Balance Sheet, Land Reform Bill, Wildlife Management in Muirburn, Forestry Grants, Natural Environment, Scotland's Food and Drink Strategy, the Rural Skills Action Plan. It goes on and on and on. How do you think, in a practical way, we can ensure that on the face of the bill, that we do have a complete list, if that can be possible, of matters that need to be considered?
So let's go back. You know, it's called a Rural Resource Plan, not an Agriculture and Crofter or Farming Crofting Support Plan. And it goes back to the purposes of the Agriculture Support Framework. There's a lot of expectations, as you've seen around the room here, that this is the biggest show in town in terms of changing our land use. Because, I go back to it, 70% of our land use is managed by farmers and crofters. And it is the biggest public fund available to incentivise land use change. So we need to get back down to that definition of what is agricultural activity, and that farmers and crofters, albeit that the bill is very framed around primarily agricultural production and land, or land use, but the huge part that those farmers and crofters have to play in sharing and sparing land for these other public purposes.
and which is reflected in all those legislation you put there. And I think the more that can be made clear, we had that, to extent we had that in the cycle of CAP programmes, which were seven-year cycles. Farmers and crofters, all land users, could see what was coming up in the next programme in the debates that were going through European Parliament and the Commission before they actually got implemented through the UK government and through to Scotland. And we're trying to replicate that process here. So that first stage of just debating what is the intervention logic of the support hasn't been done that we would have done through CAP.
Eleanor.
It's a very long list already, but so much of this is about ensuring that within the creation of the Rural Support Plan, we have that sense check of are there contradictory policies in place? Can we make sure we avoid them to avoid that unintended consequence of having things in the biodiversity consultation that don't quite align with what we've been hearing on the ag stuff and the wildlife and urban sort of codes and various things. It's so important that within the drafting of the plan, there at least an exercise that ensures there has been this overview of these interrelated policies. We saw it in the ag reform route map, as I mentioned earlier, a very long list of policies that are going to come in. Then there will be major changes within quite a lot of them that will interact with land management, and we can't ignore that. And we probably do need some sort of certainty from government that the exercise has been done and that no contradictions have been spotted, or if they have, they've been addressed. Because we can't get to a point where we have people applying for things within Tier 3 and then realising that they can't do that because of a specific thing and they're in their Tier 2 or something to do with a nature restoration programme. We can't have that because we have to look at it now.
Okay, thank you. David McCracken.
Sorry, Eleanor's already made the point I was going to make. I mean, all that long list that you read out, convener, none of that's come over the hill just today. That has been known and recognised for months, if not years. Eleanor's mentioned and since checked the actual agriculture route map. The agriculture route map, historically, in the last year, just seems to have been used as a list of different policies and bills occurring in series and with no actual linkage across them. It beggars belief that we haven't had by now, and what Eleanor's just talked about, some level of sort of sense checking with regard to each of those. Now, I appreciate many of those are the same as the agricultural bill in that the level of detail is still currently lacking. Nevertheless, it's not rocket science to actually see where there's points of synergy and potentially points of conflict that need to be addressed. So the fact that sense checking hasn't been done to now is surprising, but it certainly needs to be done sooner rather than later.
Thank you. I've got Ross McLeod and Ewan to come in and answer that question, then I'm going to move to supplementaries from Ariane Burgess and Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Just referring back to Karen's original question about what bills, we've discussed a lot about the moving parts, the interlinks between the various bills that are coming forward. I'm not going to dispute any of the relevance of those, but what I am concerned about is something that's not so much in the bills at the moment, and that is this question of finance. There's no doubt the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, for instance, leading to the Environment Bill, and for that matter the Agriculture Bill, are massively ambitious in what they want to achieve. And the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy and Environment Bill first stage has to be delivered by 2030. So I think that sets a premium on this issue of blended finance between public and private funding. And that is something I think we need to get clarified very quickly in order to provide farmers and land managers generally with the confidence to consider both public and private finance.
Ewan.
Most of my points have been comprehensively covered. I would say it's a very complicated problem to get all of those bills in there. You're not going to be able to do it. I think a reference to the vision of agriculture would be good. That's a comprehensive, covers all the ground necessary, and it will stop, as we've seen in other nations, a real kind of division between the vision as it's first proposed, and then it gets heavily diluted across a vast legislative agenda. So we would always be supportive of legislation harking back to that vision.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to direct this question to Dave Ray, I think. I'm maybe making some assumptions here in my question, but let's see. There's a great long list of agricultural forum, right? The agricultural forum list of measures. I've just been scrolling through it freely. A lot of detailed policy work in terms of agriculture, and I can make an assumption that the rural support plan will be based on that. And if that is the case, do you think that the rural support plan, when it comes forward, will actually deliver the climate mitigation and adaptation that we're going to need to meet the climate targets?
So, like pretty much every answer to this, when we're talking about this, I hope so. You know, so it should. But it's kind of, there are so many enablers that need to be in place for that. So we've got that really long list, like you say, of actions that could be taken. This links to the CPD that I'm sure we're going to get onto. It links to advisers and it links to communication. So I was reflecting just now, and I don't know how many of our farming colleagues are watching this, but probably not all of them, if I'm honest, and trying to digest, right, what does this mean for me, and looking at all those measures and kind of, well, I already do that and I don't know what that is. And I think that list is good in terms of it covers a lot of things that do need to happen and quite a lot that already is happening. But actually, the accessibility of that to every farmer and crofter and, I guess, you know, land steward, as it's been called in Scotland, I think that is a set of enablers which needs to be more overt. So my answer is, I'm ever an optimist as a climate scientist. You have to be. But I think the list alone isn't enough, clearly. And I think in terms of the kind of enabling factors to deliver all of those different practices in the right place, and this goes back to just transition, which is, you know, clearly on my mind as part of one of my roles, that's, again, my worry is that we end up with something which works for those people who are already, you know, doing stuff or basically kind of it gives benefit to people who are already benefiting and it leaves more people behind in terms of our agri and land use sector. And certainly looking at it from an academic perspective, you can kind of see absolutely the sense in terms of climate change mitigation, which is what I focus on. But actually, thinking about the people in that and thinking about every farmer in Scotland, if they are given this plan, you know, and it is well communicated, has it engaged them in that process, but has it actually been structured in a way which speaks to the context, speaks to the place, speaks to the history of that farmer or that crofter and what they're able to do? So that's always my concern is, you know, lots of good evidence, which is, I guess, our jobs, academia, but does it work for people is still a question for me.
Thanks for that.
I've got David Harley, Davey, and then Vicky.
Okay, so, we do need to make sure all the cross-checks are done, and I do think, there's, as people have said many times before, that the synergies far outweigh the conflicts. However, when it comes to delivery, the translation of that to the farm or the land or to the catchment level is absolutely crucial. For example, the CEPA regulates against about 10 general binding sets of general binding rules about land management and diffuse pollution. We spend an awful lot of time on farms explaining what those mean. They're not complicated. That's just one angle. We spent over the last 12 years, we've visited thousands of farms. We spend half a day hand-holding, you know, quite rightly, taking farmers through the requirements, helping farmers understand the advantages for them and how they manage their land, how it'll protect their soil, how it'll protect their bottom line budget. We invest an awful lot in that. That's just one angle of this, that's just water quality. So I think the translation to farm advice and that facilitation by the relevant organisations is crucial here.
Thank you. David McCracken.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to emphasise, Arian, that yes, that list you've got is long and detailed, and there could be more than should be more things on it. The vast majority of that list is focused about agriculture and agricultural practices per se, which will, if as others have indicated, stand a high chance of actually getting us some way to achieving net zero, but is well recognised, and I think I've said this at previous committee meetings, is well recognised that that will only get us some way towards net zero. Changing agricultural practices is needed, but actually it's the linkage to what we're talking about through this whole session, the nature conservation restoration elements in terms of doing more peatland restoration, more woodland, trees and woodland establishment on farms, more wetland creation, more biodiversity management, and that to me is not coming through as loud as it needs to do on that listing that you're referring to there.
Just before Vicky comes, another thought to throw into this. We need a workforce to deliver this. So where's mental health? Where's women in agriculture? Where's new entrants? Does that need to be an obligation that to be considered as part of the plan? Vicky, have you addressed the first point from Arianne as well?
Yeah, thanks. So just to add to that about, yes, we've got a list of measures that in theory can help deliver what we need to, particularly, as Davey says, when we're thinking within that agriculture sphere, but there's a whole lot of other stuff out with that that we need to do as well. But it's really going to depend upon how government applies those measures across the tiers, particularly tiers 1, 2 and 3, and how it divides the budget across those tiers and measures and how much resource it gives to any of them. And I didn't mention Tier 4 there, but that's particularly important because that is where the information, advice, knowledge transfer, training for farmers is going to sit, which is woefully underfunded at the moment, is going to be need to be a major part of making this transition in future and needs to receive much more significant investment than it does. The problem about the budget at the minute is that the accompanying documentation, the financial memorandum and other things, the government has said it's largely intending to keep the majority of funding tied to Tiers 1 and Tier 2. Now, Tiers 1 and Tier 2 largely map onto the existing sort of CAP Pillar 1 direct payments support. Together, those take 79% of the total budget, which leaves very little for Tier 3, which is about nature restoration, shorter supply chains, innovation, or Tier 4, which is about that advice. Within those two tiers, the government is saying it's Tier 2 that's going to do all the heavy lifting, but they're still talking about a 50-50 split of that nearly 80% of the budget between those two tiers. So you're still going to have an awful lot of money going into a base payment. You're only going to have a proportion of it going into Tier 2 and very little into the other tiers. So we fundamentally need to change that allocation of funding across that piece as we go forward. RSPB Scotland and Scottish Environment Link would argue we need at least three quarters of that funding on tiers 2, 3 and 4, and ultimately over time need to reduce the amount of money going to that tier 1. We can't have a situation where currently we're spending all of that, nearly 80% of that money, 62% of those direct payments go to just 20% of beneficiaries. 40% of beneficiaries get just 5% of that budget. The farmers in the Highlands and Islands and the crofters, many of whom have huge potential to deliver for nature and climate, get a really poor deal from this current CAP system, which is still operating. Unless we fundamentally change that and apply the money differently to those measures, we are not going to get to where we need to be, certainly not by 2030 and not beyond that.
Thank you. Alistair Seaman.
Thank you. Just in terms of the integration piece, I want to flag two things that have been really significant for us. The first links to crofting and common grazings in particular. We're in a situation where we don't actually have a conflict. We have a crofting development plan that articulates a desire to do exactly what we're saying needs to be done, but we don't have the mechanisms to support that. largely because in previous rounds, crofters have had to kind of shoehorn, we've had to shoehorn the support we give to crofters into something that was built for something else, and we have to avoid that mistake this time round. We've got crofting legislation coming up, but we've got to make sure that we build a support structure for crofting, and on common grazings in particular, that recognises the unique opportunities of that space. And the second is actually a just transition issue here. And we work quite a lot with natural capital developments, particularly Woodland Carbon Code. We're in a position where an absentee firm landowner can access those markets very easily. A crofter with a common grazing tenancy can't. And that's just fundamentally not right. And that's something that we've got to address going forward. And the second links to the role of trees in all of this. Currently, most of the tree budget sits in the forest grant scheme, which we've heard, sadly, has taken a really significant hit. But a lot of what we have outlined in the publication I shared isn't going to be funded through that. It's going to have to be funded through this system. And we really want to see, I would just echo what Vicky says, that has to sit in Tier 2. It can't sit beyond that. If we're going to see this taken up at scale, then it has to be incredibly visible for farmers. It has to be simple. It has to be straightforward. It has to be non-competitive. And it has to be sitting there amongst the main menu of options, not in some kind of ambitious cupboard if you're keen enough to go through to Tier 3 or Tier 4.
I've got Ross Lilly, Ross McLeod and Davey back in, and then I've got a short supplementary from Rachel Hamilton and a question from Alistair Allen.
So go back to the question. I mean, 50% of our emissions in Scotland come from land. The way that the bill and the intention of the rural resource plan is focused on emissions largely from agricultural activity. Certainly the carbon audits that farmers are expected to carry out and are doing is focusing on how they reduce the emissions from their activity, from their business. But actually the large part of that 50% of emissions is coming from what's termed in the climate change plan as land use change and forestry elements. It's the permanent pasture, it's the woodlands, it's the peatlands on the farm, as well as rather than the arable soils. And a lot of this comes down to the cultural issue around how farmers see themselves as, first and foremost, farmers and crofters producing food, and less so the ones who are the custodians of those habitats that are actually where our emissions are coming from. We need to stop the emissions and we need indeed use those to capture carbon from a purely kind of climate perspective. There are some really good examples in Scotland of farmers who understand that. They embrace that and still call themselves farmers. In fact, by doing so, they've actually accessed new markets that boost their credibility and their confidence of being a farmer in terms of producing new products, milk products and so on. So we've got to find a way of signalling that it's okay to take part, and you can do and facilitate the point that Alistair made there, putting land sparing for woodland, for peatland restoration, albeit within the farm every farm croft context, it doesn't need to be a whole holding process. It's sharing does a lot of the lifting. One of the fears, I think, from farmers embracing this element of climate adaptation is that they've seen whole holdings and whole estates moving out of farming into what's considered the green-led approach. And that doesn't need to happen. If we can get this support framework right, and the definition of agriculture and agricultural support embraces these other habitats, then we can avoid that.
Thank you. Ross McLeod.
Thank you. I just want to go back to a point that Vicky raised about the way in which the Rural Support Plan engages with farmers, and also in relation to carbon audits, which Ross has mentioned. Carbon audits are seen as a sort of fundamental building block towards change and focus on outcomes with its assessment of greenhouse gas emissions and sequestration. I think when I last looked, or could last find a figure on the amount of carbon audit take-up, was from August last year, and it's about 550. I dare say someone might be able to tell me what the current figure is, but it doesn't strike me as being very many when we've got 18,000 farming units in Scotland. So it strikes me that there's something going awry in terms of the way we either engage with farmers, communicate with farmers, but we've got to get our skates on if we're going to make that change.
Thank you. David McCracken.
Thank you, Convener. I would just come back to one of the questions you posed at the start of this particular session. The supporting documents for the framework highlight that it's believed that the framework remains broadly aligned with the CAP. But as you've just pointed out a few minutes ago, there's no mention in the framework about new entrants. There's no mention in the framework about small producers, both of which are mandatory elements of the current CAP 23 to 27. There's two issues there. One is the issue that you were implying, I'm presuming, about how do we actually make sure we get a refresh of new entrants coming into Scottish agriculture to deliver these multiple objectives going forward. And the framework's currently silent on that. But also with regard, and just as importantly, with regard to small producers, we've talked for the last couple of hours about the range of different asks that's going to be made of Scottish farmers and crofters going forward. We need to be careful to assess the burden that we're going to be putting on farmers and crofters, particularly small farmers and crofters, who may only be in receipt of a relatively small amount of money. And if we're asking them to do a whole host of additional things voluntarily to actually receive that money, there's a real danger that they will just actually walk away, not just walk away from agricultural production, but walk away from any of the additional benefits that can arise from that agricultural production from a nature and a climate perspective. So the fact that the framework is silent on both these things is a concern.
Thank you. I've now got a supplementary from Rachel Hamilton on this.
Alistair Seaman mentioned the real terms cut to the Scottish forestry budget. That is 33.6 million. I want to ask Stuart Goodall what impact that will have on the Scottish Government's climate change plan, particularly around the Scottish forestry strategy, and will that have an impact or a burden that will be transferred to other agricultural activities in Scottish farming?
That's a very good question. I'm very happy to answer it as well on my own. I mean, in terms of the contribution that tree planting can make to the climate change plan, that was identified as 18,000 hectares by in next year. Clearly, the funding that's available there is nowhere near enough to be able to deliver that. A lot depends on what type of tree planting you do, because there's different costs associated with different types of tree planting. But our best guess is there's probably enough funding there in the grants budget for about half that target. So there's definitely going to be a significant shortfall. I can't see, speaking from a climate change perspective, where other actions will take the heavy lifting required in order to meet the climate change target. So as it currently stands, it looks to me as though it's just putting in place or taking one brick out of the wall that's needed to be able to achieve the target. We're very concerned that the level of planting that could be delivered under this funding will result in job losses. I've already had forest nurseries getting in touch with me. They've gone through a torrid time over the last 10 to 12 years in terms of cyclical delivery of tree planting, having to destroy literally hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of trees, you know, burning them, ploughing them into the ground. We were looking at a situation where tree nurseries were being encouraged to increase capacity, to invest. I think now they'll be looking at how do they reduce capacity, how do they disinvest, how do they lay people off. So from a forestry perspective, we are incredibly concerned about that. From a climate change perspective, I'm incredibly concerned about that. And I do look at it, you know, picking up your second question, in terms of, you know, land use change in forestry, the tree planting element was the big significant component that was going to be able to enable a rural community, you know, farmers as well. You know, we're looking for farmers to embrace tree planting as part of their rural enterprise as a means to be able to deliver that target. And the question now becomes, how do you achieve the reductions that will be sought from the rural sector, from the agricultural sector? Because I'm not an expert on this, something like Dave's better place, but I struggle to see how we can meet our net zero targets of 2045 without tree planting at the level that's required. It just seems to me that we're setting ourselves up to fail, and it will put pressure on the land use, the land use change forestry heading and say, where is that contribution going to come from now? So I think there's real concern out there, and I'm receiving emails constantly from people in the sector.
Just to pull this back to the draft bill that we've got and the rural support plan that we're scrutinising just now, so is there a way through that, through, you know, have regard to or matters to be considered in Section 3 of the bill, do you foresee that there should be something in the face of the bill that gives more certainty to the forestry sector?
That's the fundamental challenge here is that we approach this bill initially as effective enabling mechanism. It was an opportunity for Scottish Government to take the powers post-CAP to be able to continue to provide the grants that have been provided and to deliver the plans that we have for climate change, rural economies, etc. And the concern is that this is not providing any of that financial security, and it will result in businesses and people who are considering planting, all types of landowners, from reducing their plans. And if we end up falling backwards, it's going to take us many years to get back onto the front foot. So definitely something which said it's highly, incredibly important that there is that security, that confidence provided for the forestry sector would be very welcome.
Okay, thank you. Ross Lilly.
I just want to point that this puts more emphasis on the need to allow the bill and the rural support framework to enable that market intervention, because if there's one major restoration market that really is ready to go and is actually shows demonstration that can work on the ground, it's woodland, and particularly multi-purpose diverse woodland. The markets, particularly financial institutions, are ready to invest in that. If we can, again, if a government can signal and provide a platform to do that trading. So these elements, discussions we've had around the rural support framework and the intervention logic being set out so that it gives the confidence both to the farmer, land manager and the industry, then they can enable that private market to fill some of the gap in the public support.
Thank you. Before I bring Vicky in, Alistair has got an additional supplementary for some clarification. Alistair.
Just on the point that the convener raised there about have regard to when it comes to the support plan. So what do you think ministers should have regard to? And I've asked this in a previous context. I know there's a kind of well understood legal meaning of what have regard to means. But what's your understanding of that, and what should be had regard to, and how should that be made enforceable?
Vicky, do you want to answer that as well as
I can try. We did comment on that in our evidence. I mean, there's a bit of a circular thing going on in the bill about what ministers must have regard to and in producing the plan, which refers back to the objectives. And obviously, that's quite a weak form of wording, in a sense, just to simply have regard to. So I think there is scope to tighten up in the bill in terms of what ministers actually must do in terms of enacting that rural support plan, which will then in turn deliver the objectives. I just wanted to touch on the woodland and forestry question, but just to throw a slightly different complexion. Obviously, we need woodland creation, but just to say that is not only achieved just by planting, and some of that can be achieved through some of that private sector funding, but also there's natural colonisation, and if we tackle deer numbers and get those down, we could create about 250,000 hectares of woodland, probably native woodland, building out from our existing native woodland blocks. It's also, just to put things in context, and it was mentioned before, I think, by Dave, but the scale of our peatland emissions is by far one of the biggest factors that we need to think about. So I'm not arguing against forestry or woodland expansion, but we absolutely, in terms of overall emissions from the land sector, have to tackle those degraded peatlands, 1.4 million hectares, which are a major source, and actually currently outweigh those sequestration and storage from all that tree planting. So we absolutely need both, but we've really got to get on top of that appeal. And there are measures within this, particularly in Tier 3 and that nature restoration piece, as well as the Peatland Action Fund and other things, that can help us get on with that. But there are capacity issues, actually, in that sector. So your point, Finlay, about people and bringing new entrants in, and young people coming into jobs and future careers, there's much more we need to do in that space as well. But there's big opportunity there.
Okay. Rachel's got a point of clarification.
To Vicky Swales, the financial memorandum doesn't include Scottish Government funding for Peatland Action Fund within the context of the Agricultural Bill.
No, but there are elements of it which would sit and already currently sit within the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme. So there's a crossover. There's Peatland Action Fund, but there's also Peatland Restoration and other activities within what could be the replacement for AICs in future and in that Tier 3 measure.
Okay.
Would anybody else like to comment on the have regard to before we move on to Stuart?
Thank you, Convener. I mean, in light of the conversation we just had, I think it would be very helpful to have something in there which says have regard to the forestry sector. I mean, we do have the issue of the Scottish Forestry Strategy being developed as a separate activity, and we have this bill which provides the funding mechanism. And whereas I think in policy terms there is sense in the Scottish Forestry Strategy having primacy in terms of ensuring that there is the confidence and the security of funding, I think that would be a key thing to have regard to for the forestry sector.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to move on to our next theme, which is looking at powers to develop a new agricultural support system. A question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm going to actually roll a number of questions together, but as the Convener said, it's part two of the bill, and it gives Ministers the powers to establish new funding and support system for Scottish agriculture, and that includes things like conditions, eligibility requirements, guidance, capping, refusing or recovering support, and exceptional market conditions. And I know some folks have already started to touch on things like bits of detail on the tiers and the split on that. But it would be helpful to hear if you think your thoughts about the level of detail that's set out on the face of the bill and on any particular powers around those support measures, whether you have a sense of confidence from the bill that the new agricultural support system will deliver for nature and climate. We've kind of touched on that already a bit. And if you think the information on anticipated future funding splits, so that's the tiers set on the out in the financial memorandum is adequate. And also to, and again, this has been touched on, but anyone else can come in on that, your views on the power to cap agricultural payments, so capping and potentially tapering, front loading, and the benefits and pros and cons on those. And then also, of course, we would want to ask you about parliamentary scrutiny on the use of the powers in Part 2 and the overall shape of the new agriculture policy. And then our favourite topic seems to be, I think, today, monitoring and evaluation. So a lot there. Pick up anything that struck your imagination as I went through all of that. Who'd like to
Eleanor
start
to kick off?
Eleanor.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, straight in. So on part two, we do have some concerns about a sort of general insufficient level of consultation, but I've got some sort of key ones. On section seven, so guidance, the fact that this can sort of specify the extent to which compliance with guidance on a particular topic is relevant on sort of conditions of support, but also guidance as evidential value in legal proceedings, does make me concerned about it being negative procedure and there being no reference to consultation. I think that needs to change. I'll try not to take too much time up with these. On capping, I think we need something on the bill about a requirement to provide impact assessments or modelling on what the impact of moving this money will deliver. We're not in favour of capping, which won't come as a surprise. We've never been in favour of capping. And we particularly don't want to see any capping linked to environmental payments. Understanding the arguments for capping when we have basic payments, but when we look at Tier 1 requirements, the cost of delivering a whole farm plan, even just soil health assessments,
doesn't go down just by the amount of land you are testing, not significantly. There does need to be some clear assessment as to the costs of these two businesses before we start looking at capping and tapering. On section 10, again, we think this needs a bit more scrutiny than it currently has. And in section 13, particularly paragraph 5, we don't think the things that constitute a significant provision to trigger the affirmative procedure is broad enough. There's a lot of stuff that could easily go through as negative procedure, which does not give us the sort of time needed to scrutinise. Those are my initial thoughts.
Thank you. Vicky.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I'll pick up on, I hope I've been clear that in terms of the tier funding splits, that it isn't adequate and absolutely needs to change. But just to pick up on issues around capping and front-loading or redistributive payments. So we already have powers to cap payments, albeit they haven't been applied particularly strongly in Scotland. And those powers, as I understand it, need to be taken forward as the retained EU law bill and its clauses come to an end. So that's important. I would support what Eleanor says, although we do support capping, we think it should be applied to those base payments going forward, those income support payments, but not to other payments where they are clearly targeted at delivering certain outcomes and where the delivery of those outcomes is likely to increase at scale. So particularly some of that environmental land management, it makes sense that if you're delivering a lot, you should be able to get the appropriate payments to support that activity. There has been discussion in the policy arena around redistributive payments, or what the NFUS are calling front-loading in that base payment tier. We think that would be helpful. So this is the idea of giving an uplift in the payment rates to a first number of hectares, a figure to be defined, but were particularly beneficial to those smaller farmers and crofters who may struggle with some of the other requirements being placed on them. So I think that would be absolutely a very sensible thing to do.
Vicky, on that, because it's quite an important part of the bill and something we've discussed quite a lot. Once again, looking at the bill we've got in front of us, should there be some guidelines on how that front-loading, or however you might like to call it, or capping, might look? And is there parameters that... So it may not be 10%, 20% or whatever, but does it need to specify in the front of the bill what considerations need to be looked at if a potential front-loading or capping was to be introduced?
Well, I think it certainly needs to specify that. I'm not sure at the minute that it actually has that in at all. So I think basically for that to be, to create the powers for that to be a mechanism, I don't think it necessarily needs all the detail of how that might be done. But again, we can look at the cap and it is a 10% figure at the minute. Some modelling work would need to be done in Scotland, but certainly something, provisions in the bill to create the powers to do that, I think is absolutely needed.
Okay. Anyone else on these particular? Ross Lilly.
I think as long as the emphasis is on the first two tiers, the base payment, to give confidence and surety to the industry that they continue to be supported, but at the same time deliver on all these targets that we've just been talking about, then we need to think about the distribution of payments around that base payment. And so I think the region modelling is quite critical to get right. And I think Davey mentioned it earlier on in this morning about the fact that it's not only the case that, in terms of the ambitions of the bill, if we need every farm and crofter to do more for nature and for climate, as well as concentrate on food production, then needs to be more parity across the farming and crofting industry about the distribution of those payments. You know, the disparity between Region 1 and Region 2 payments, for instance, at the moment is quite significant.
See that, depending on the code of practice and conditionality, will that not effectively do some of the work that we might want to see undertaken in Tier 2? It might be some of the conditionality is in relation to the code of practice might be set out some of the rules that you need to use, and in that way deliver some of the outcomes we want to see in other parts of the bill.
again, goes back to the need to set out the intervention logic across the four tiers and how they work together. So tier one base provides the baseline, the auditing, the baselines, setting the baseline of which agreeing to the code is, and complying by the code is part of. But then the means to actually do that and go beyond the base requirements of the code would be supported by enhanced. And then more specific actions, particularly business change, like capital investment to make a change in the business, would come out sort of tier three. So that logic needs to flow through.
Okay. Vicky.
And I think it speaks to what we were talking about before, about which measures you apply where. What are the basic requirements, as in cross-compliance, that you just have to do in order to get that entry payment under the base tier? But then thinking, well, actually, what do we need to do in terms of the maybe things that cost farmers a little bit more money to do? Where do we need to support that through different measures through Tier 2, which, as I say, is being seen by government as doing a lot of the heavy lifting in this space, and they're intending to put quite a bit of money into it. But arguably, we would add into Tier 3s and ultimately into Tier 4 and providing that cross-cutting support in terms of advice. But they are, I understand, looking at cross-compliance conditions and the good agricultural environmental conditions that might apply, discussion around things like including a sort of peatland and wetland conditions in some of that. So it is possible to increase the sort of baseline requirements before you even get to a point of thinking, well, what do we need to pay and support farmers to do?
Okay. Okay, Ariane and then Rachel.
Thanks, Convener. Just a brief supplementary on the tier system. Vicky, you may have touched on it already, but I think last week at the roundtable, I started to understand an idea that we'll have a tier system that might start out in one way in 2025, 26, but it will evolve as farming practices change. Money might need to move into different tiers. Is that the idea?
I think that's certainly the case. Obviously, there's a lot of discussions around transition, just transition, and taking things in a stepwise direction. I mean, obviously, I would say we are behind the curve. We've not made the progress to date we need to, but we have to accept that we are where we are and, you know, how we move forward. So the point is, at the moment, as I said, about 79% of that budget will effectively be, as it appears to be, going to be allocated to those tiers one and tiers two. Whether that needs to remain the case in perpetuity, I think, is an open question. It's not clear from the government's position at the minute of whether this is just a starting point or whether we're going to get to a different end point and we're going to transition over time. We would argue there does need to be a transition. We need to move that money away, as I've said, but we accept that you can't necessarily do it immediately overnight. But I think the sooner government sets out its plans, and that's why the rural support plan coming forward is so critical in all of this, that's where they should be explaining all of this and saying what their decisions are. But we do understand the Cabinet Secretary has said that she will make some decisions about funding envelopes by the time of the NFUS AGM in February, particularly in relation to Tier 1 and Tier 2. So we have to wait and see what comes forward from that. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. In terms of basic requirements and the sort of conditionality for farmers, I think it would help to clarify what we mean by ineligible land and active farming. And so I think it was a point Nigel Miller raised the other day, that some farmers may be capable of delivering in terms of biodiversity because that's the scope of their land, but they may be constrained at the moment by those definitions of ineligibility in terms of the area of land, you know, scrub, bracken, whatever it is, which could be used for biodiversity purposes quite constructively. So I think it goes to the sort of concept of integrated land management and making sure that farmers have the scope to deliver either for biodiversity and or for productive and efficient farming.
Rachel Hamilton.
I wanted to ask Eleanor Kay, around the eligibility criteria for support. I know that it doesn't necessarily speak about the farmers that can participate, such as tenant farmers. I wondered if you had a view on whether tenant farmers within that section should be explicitly referred to, and on the last point around the transparency in land ownership, is it possible through the Land Register of Scotland to ensure transparency of land ownership?
I don't think we necessarily need to name tenants specifically in section 14. I think there will be an element of this that crosses over into what's covered in the ag holdings aspect of the land reform bill. So I don't really want to preempt what's in that. I'd say the register is pretty transparent. There's obviously a requirement to make sure your land is registered. I think it is sufficient.
Do you think that specifically tenant farmers should be referenced to so that they can get access to some of the possible tier 3 and 4 activities?
I don't think necessarily. I think it's there within the sort of payment entitlements section. There's scope for it to be specified if needs be. But I wouldn't want to talk to stuff that I expect is going to come in the land reform bill.
Okay, thanks.
Hey, Ariane Burgess.
Thanks. I wanted to ask anyone who wants to pick this question up around any new support schemes that you would like to see created. For example, at the moment, I think I'm aware that landowners with land, I think it's 3 hectares or less, aren't eligible for any form of support, and yet there's quite a strong demand for market gardening and that kind of thing. So I'd be just interested to hear if you agree with that one, but also other schemes that you might think would be good to see that would, again, help us with that nature and climate target action.
I've got Davy, the Elner, Kirsty, and then Ross Lilly.
Apologies. Sorry. So I was coming in on Rachel's question a minute ago initially, but I'll try and answer Ariane's as well. It's not my area, but I just wanted to point out in SRUC's submission to the consultation, your question about the land registry, Rachel. There are currently no links between the existing administrative framework for agricultural support and the land registry. An owner and a claimant need not be the same person. Ownership boundaries don't align to agricultural holdings and land parcels, etc., etc. So the land registry is not an easy fix to actually knowing what's happening on agricultural land or vice versa. Going back to Ariane's question, I appreciate Ariane, you're coming at it more from the sort of a small farmer perspective. The point I was going to make was I would be suggesting that there is a need to transition from our existing support policy into the new support policy fully in some sort of shape or form. And what's currently missing within that, or within any sort of real consideration within the framework or any of the ongoing and detailed discussions about the secondary policies, is what happens to less favoured area support payments going forward. That is a big for the type of farmers that we work with in the hills and uplands and crofting areas of Scotland. Then less favoured area support is a big part of their public funding going forward. And there's been very little active discussion about how that will actually be dealt with going forward. And so my response to yourself, Ariane, is before we start thinking about some other different support mechanisms, we need to be clear whether or not elements of that is going to go forward, so that those individuals currently in receipt of that are aware whether some element of it will continue, what the outcomes will be required of them to continue to receive that or not, and if it's or not, when will that actually cease being something that they will have access to.
Okay, thank you. We'll get Eleanor and then Kirsty.
It was just following on from David's point on those sort of smaller parcels of land. I do wonder if there is scope to provide support for those through the rurals, the sort of rural economy aspect of the sort of Schedule 1. I think I wonder if it's broad enough that can be fit within that. They are quite different to sort of farming systems. And I also think there's potentially scope for it to be in the Good Food Nation sort of secondary legislation piece. So I agree, things like allotments and market gardens are are certainly something where we can engage with the sort of wider community as to the importance of climate adaptation and food production. It's a great tool, but I think it probably needs a different support than agricultural stuff.
Thank you. Kirsty.
So I think we have to look at this in the round, don't we? I mean, at FSCC we talk about pathways, and it's pathways for all farmers, crofters and growers. So we have to sense check what we're doing, and you mentioned different legislation there, Eleanor, about where the opportunities might be. But there's no, I don't get a feeling there is that kind of sense checking at the moment to make sure, both in public funding and private funding, that there's pathways for all. And I think this is going to be really integral, especially for, you know, we have an issue about young entrants and actually the ability of just not young entrants farm, but people to actually enter this sector and play their part in this sector and secure, and not just access to land, but secure access to land. So I think we have a huge problem in Scotland actually at the moment, and we are facing rural depopulation. So we have to look at this in the round, and we have to look at all the different legislations to make sure that there's pathways for all sizes, all types, and there's opportunities for new entrants to come in. That can be done in many ways, but I think there's a bit of sense checking we need to do across the board.
Thank you. Ross Lilley, followed by Alistair.
Good magic question about what could be added in terms of that's not there at the moment. I mean, we've talked about the support framework supporting an ecosystem, a service approach, which is the right thing to do. And certainly the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy and Delivery Plan is focused around ecosystem services and ecosystems itself. But we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that at the heart of ecosystems is our species, and a lot of what the public at large and certainly farmers view biodiversity is in individual species. And the way we approach our species protection and management and interaction in Scotland is on a spectrum from a fully protected species on one hand and at least of conservation concern to a fully utilisable or indeed a non-native invasive. And I think we should try and not necessarily develop new schemes, but think about the framework and how it's supporting farmers and crofters manage that complexity of species status from at both ends. It's quite easy at each end. We know if it's a non-native invasive, then let's try and get eradicate it and control it. If it's a protected species of concern at the other end, then we've got some good examples of doing that. The Agri-Environment Climate Scheme currently supports and has good success stories there in things like corn crakes and marsh tilly and so on. But there's a number of species in the middle there, and we've touched on a few earlier in terms of things like beavers, where there's a complex way of how we manage those. They have conservation concerns, so we should be able to use the support framework to help farmers support and host to those species, but at the same time use the other tools available, such as licensing and to manage individual animals. So that, I think we should try and articulate that in the framework. And then, you know, just coming down to where we could actually have the new measures, two big ones to help us ease this land use change. One is trees on farms, and I say that deliberately, compared to woodland, because current woodland is considered down to sort of like 200 stems per hectare. But actually, there's a huge amount of woodland expansion we could do through much, much lower densities and stitching trees into farmland. And that could be very much part of the support framework, rather than a separate forestry grant scheme the way we currently do it. And the other one is deer. On that species framework, deer at the bottom end is a utilisable resource that is abundant and is hindering all of those aspects of land use change, peatland restoration, woodland expansion. So we could have an overtly deer incentive there.
Okay, thank you. Vicky.
I'd certainly support those comments about trees on farms and deers, but I was just going to answer Ariane. In terms of thinking about additional schemes of support, I think I mentioned earlier that there doesn't appear to be provision in Schedule 1 for kind of payments for facilitation for collaborative management for landscape scale. Under the previous Rural Development Programme, there was supposed to be an Environmental Cooperation Action Fund, which never got off the ground, but we need to make sure that's part of the future policy and the provisions are there for that. And I just wanted to pick up briefly on Davey's point about the Less Favoured Area Support Scheme. The financial memorandum suggests that in this context, the budget for Tiers 1 and 2 would include the Less Favoured Area Support Scheme budget of £66 million. actually, if you add that into the pot, then the amount of money spent on those two tiers would be 89% of the budget, not the 79% that I mentioned before. Nonetheless, if that's the case, then we would suggest that that needs to be retained within Tier 2, and we've made a case for a specific high nature value farming and crofting support. We've got the indicator, we know that about 40% of Scotland is what we would class as high nature value farming and crofting, predominantly in the Highlands and Islands, that get a very poor deal from the current system. But that's also the areas where we have a high proportion of our most important wildlife sites, also carbon stores. So there's real merit in ensuring those smaller farms and crofts, which are environmentally important but quite economically fragile and vulnerable, can be supported going forward and get a fair deal from the system.
Thank you. Alistair, my apologies. I meant to bring you in earlier.
That's all right. Thank you. Actually, no, I'm going to echo a lot of what Ross said. I think on deer, absolutely, we'd support that. A lot of the work on deer currently is looking at deer in the uplands on large estates. There's been some progress there, but it's really tricky in lowland Scotland, and therefore I think the opportunity to resource landowners and farmers to do that well in the lowlands, a lot of that's going to require the kind of collaboration that Vicky mentioned. I think that's definitely an area to look at. And I just wanted to add a little bit of colour to Ross's comment on trees on farms and just reinforce the point that the Forestry Grant Scheme is there to create woodland and forests, but there's a huge opportunity to put trees into farms in other ways. And I want to specifically mention hedges. Vicky kicked off with that. We lost 6,000 miles of our hedgerows in Scotland in the last century. These have opportunity to create biodiversity superhighways across some of our least biodiverse land. SEPA have looked at water quality, identified 175,000 hectares of river and water stream corridor where we need to put trees back in. Again, there's opportunities to do that through FGS, but a lot of that can be done outside of that. Davey's sitting behind a lovely photograph of, I think, a protected water margin that he and I looked at fairly recently. Opportunities to integrate trees into that space are very significant. And then lastly, coming to grazing, which is a huge part of Scotland's agriculture, we need to put trees into that space, not in woodland, but as individual trees, small copses, to create the shade and the shelter that's going to be absolutely fundamental to livestock well-being and to productivity going forward, and actually is perhaps one of the biggest opportunities for boosting biodiversity in that landscape. That will never be funded through the Forestry Grant Scheme. We've got to find creative ways to put that in here. We're working with Soil Association Scotland at the moment to look at the details of that and recognising that those schemes don't just need to cover the capital costs and the maintenance costs, but we also want to look at what a realistic payment for ecosystem services would be through that. So just a flag, I'm keen to hear from any colleagues here who might be interested in connecting with me on that later on, because that's something we want to be publishing towards the summer this year.
Thank you. We're going to move on to our final theme, the power to provide for CPD. I'm going to bring in Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and it's been quite an interesting session so far. I'm sorry I'm not in the room with you. On the CPD issue, and I might go to Kirsty first since she raised the issue early on in the session, to ask about the power to provide CPD and whether there's any particular areas that should be required and or particularly encouraged. And Kirsty, you mentioned there was a knowledge and skills gap, and I wondered if you could expand on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the CPD aspect of this bill is going to be incredibly important, but I think it will be how we actually implement that's going to be incredibly important as well, because obviously we want farmers and crofters and growers to want to do it, not to feel they have to do it. It's got to work in with their systems and their farms. As we know, every farm and every croft and every market garden is very unique. And the needs will be different. The way I've been working within this knowledge transfer world is looking at peer-to-peer and how actually farmers and crofters can learn from each other, and that knowledge transfer, from what I've seen over the last 3 years, that works really well. There's a level of trust. There's something in actually seeing something to believe it. When we talk about, you know, these are big, big changes that we're asking farmers and crofters and growers to do in an environment that isn't really set up that makes sense for them at the moment. There's no particular market routes, or, you know, it is quite a, that will develop, the supply chain will develop, that will push change on to farmers and crofters, but at the moment they're kind of doing it against the grain. So I think there's a level of trust there. We would, I think what's really important, that farmers and crofters and growers have the options to choose, and to choose what fits them and what they need at a particular time. So yeah, I think it's a very important part of the bill, but again, you know, it shouldn't be imposed upon. It should be something that is seen as useful within their businesses to actually do, and I think that's going to be important how we roll this out.
Thank you. Eleanor.
I think CBD is obviously going to be incredibly important as the vision for agriculture is delivered, and may or must is a very important sort of comment in this section. And there are questions to be asked as to exactly how it's applied. And as Kirsty said, we have to be clear on what the benefits are to the business for engaging with CPD. And we know that will directly affect the uptake. A lot of these, a lot of the solutions that we need will require very similar activity, but the reason for doing it for a business will be different. And we need to acknowledge that. But I think before we impose any kind of CPD requirement, we need to ensure we actually have enough advisors and trainers, and we simply don't for what's currently delivered. I think there needs to be a qualification as to what constitutes CPD. So it's okay to have varying levels of CPD, but a monitor farm meeting attendance is very different to my basis integrated pest management qualification or the livestock handling course held by a vet. These are different things, and they will need to be sort of slightly viewed differently. They all achieve something very important. And there's also an element of not just choosing the cheapest option to tick the box, and that's critical to ensure this is remotely meaningful. We expect there needs to be some level of equivalence granted to the existing professional qualifications. So your Institute of Agricultural Valuers, Agricultural Management Basis, there's a whole stream of them that can be listed and must be recognised in this if CPD is to be required. There also, I think, needs to be something within this section on the availability and accessibility of the information. So we've heard it from RSABI that approximately 25% of farmers are thought to be dyslexic. We know that with a higher proportion of farmers being men, they're more likely to be colourblind, for instance, and an older population is most likely to have hearing issues. How they access information will entirely depend on whether or not they use it. And if it's not accessible, it will not be used, no matter how much you impose upon them. And the same thing applies when we look at barriers to entry for women and new entrants and general equipment availability. So things need to be delivered. You know, this is very important content. It has to be delivered in a multitude of ways. And that makes things expensive. And that needs to be factored in when we're looking at the CPD requirements, that yes, we will need some on-farm meetings for particular regions if you're wanting to create catchment area change. There will need to be in-person meetings, but there will need to be an online offering as well, and all these things add to the complexity. There also needs to be a measure of quality for the person delivering the information, particularly with Regen Ag. I think we are seeing a worrying increase of professionals giving anecdotal data that has no scientific rigour to it at all, and they are very expensive and potentially deliver nothing of benefit, but the minute you get caught out by it, you're kind of put off doing anything else in the future. So we need to get this right. Knowledge exchange is key, but there needs to be an engagement with the sector as to what's already out there, what professional qualifications already exist that will interact with this. And at the moment, there is nothing in this section about consultation with the sector.
Okay, thank you. Dave Rae.
Thanks, and Kirsty and Eleanor have covered that really well. The thing I'd emphasise, Eleanor was talking about we need more advisors, we need more capacity, and I completely agree with that, but they also need this CPD, the CPD they receive, to reflect the urgency of this, but also the breadth and depth of it. And I think that's potentially a huge enabler, just in terms of that phase one-to-one. When you're doing your IAX return, having an advisor who knows, who can explain this, can explain this discussion we've had this morning, but actually what the bill is, what the measures are, that big list, that's quite a big ask of them, but I think that's the kind of thing they should be asked to do. But it comes back to resource. That needs to be resourced properly, and that's not a small part. And Vicky made the point about how that kind of Tier 4 budget doesn't match what is required in terms of that CPD and that support through advisors.
Thank you. I've got Ewan and then Davey.
Yeah, a whole host of difficulties with the current advisory capacity have been raised. I think we need to recognise that there is a real wealth of knowledge already out there. You know, to pardon the pun, there are organic networks growing, like the Nature Friendly Farming Network. There's the, I believe it's the Southwest Regenerative Farming Network. And those skills that have already been fostered across farms and crofts, whether they're part of those networks or just in the mainstream system operating on their own, need to really be utilised, because there is a vast resource there. We've seen, and I would encourage the committee to look at CATIF work on these kind of farmer-to-farmer, crofter-to-crofter clusters, you know, where they are geographically closely located. Obviously, there are problems when it comes to the Highlands and Islands of just getting around the area. But they have been really, really important in helping to upskill farmers and crofters and introduce them to potentially new nature-friendly farming techniques. I'd also like to go back to Vicky's point on the funding. I would echo everything that she said about the funding allocation being insufficient. There isn't a particular ring fence around Tier 4 funding, and we see that, as you know, the budget allocation is subject to periodic uncertainties, and there's also climate change shocks and things. The knowledge transfer is going to be so key to weatherproofing farms from both economic and climate shocks.
Hey, Jim, you got a question on that point?
Ewan, it's to all of you, but just specifically on the point that you've just made there, you're talking about there is so much knowledge transfer out there. Absolutely in favour of that. But this is called continuous professional development. Are you saying that these organisations that are doing that have to be professionally registered? And if so, with who? If they aren't, then the scrutiny of the government's ability to deliver its objectives will then come back to, well, who did you ask to deliver it and where did the knowledge come from? So I can potentially see that there will be an issue there further down the line if we don't have some kind of process to make sure that what we're asking people to do is delivered by the right people on the basis of something that the government is then answerable to.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't feel confident responding now, so I will write to you following up on that point.
Okay, thank you. I've now got Davey and then Ross Lilly.
Thank you, and thank you for your question, Beatrice. Just a number of things with regard to it. Kirsty name-checked me earlier in this morning's conversation when she was talking not just about CPD, but about wider education and training, and I think it's important, as we've also identified here, that the bill has lots of linkages to other policies, natural environment bill, et cetera. It's important that we also recognise that the scale of change that we are looking to achieve in land management in Scotland, only an element of that can actually be achieved in terms of skills development, can be achieved through the CPD that's been talked about here within the Agricultural Framework Bill. And so our wider education and skills delivery within Scotland needs to be a greater alignment with what we actually need going forward. I potentially, with the education skills teams that I have within SRUC, I could potentially create a 2-day course or a week-long course tomorrow to fill a skills gap. But if it comes to a sort of a year-long HNC or 3 or 4 year-long degree, that takes a lot longer, slower burn to actually change, because it's not just in my gift to actually do that. It's within the gift of the Scottish Funding Council and Skills Development Scotland to actually also agree that we can support those type of things going forward. So there is a need for us to actually think carefully about what are the skills that we need both on our farms and for individuals to actually help our farmers and crofters going forward, and how we might actually seek to facilitate that across Scotland going forward. Upskilling and reskilling is going to be vital, not just of our farmers and existing farmers and crofters or those new entrants, but others to actually help them on that way. With regard to CPD itself, then certainly, CPD in all its guises is important, but it's not an outcome in itself. It's not. It shouldn't be. You know, you have to actually do a certain amount of CPD, 3 hours of CPD per every 6 months to actually continue to qualify for your eligibility of payment, sort of thing. That is just a tick box exercise that achieves nothing. CPD, whatever it is, needs to actually have a clear relationship, a clear outcome to what the farmer or the crofter needs to actually achieve on their farm or croft, how relevant it actually is to helping them actually do that. I've already mentioned the scale of the change that's actually needed. Others have mentioned there's limited existing knowledge for many of these multiple outcomes we're now going to be looking for from farms and crofts, not just amongst the farmers and crofters themselves, but amongst those who are currently advising them. So it's not just a low number of advisors that's currently available. It's a low number, a low proportion of those currently available advisors can also now give appropriate training or advice on the range of activities that we're seeing as important going forward. And certainly with regard to Jim's point, then we have to look at some level of a sort of accreditation going forward if we want to actually achieve the real degree of uplift in knowledge and understanding amongst farmers and crofters going forward. And the final thing I just wanted to say is we also need to think outside the box. A number of people have already mentioned it. Peer-to-peer learning, advisor to farmer crofter learning can be important, but we also have to think how else it's going to be more effective at actually more effective at achieving those sort of outcomes. And as a number of people have already mentioned, some level of sort of facilitation going forward for some groupings of farmers may be akin to producing a better outcome, even if it's more expensive to achieve. KTIF has already been mentioned, but if we look to the Republic of Ireland, we're doing nothing like the scale of KTIF-type projects that the Republic of Ireland have done from a bottom-up sort of perspective, putting facilitation in place. And then just to bring it full circle, you know, CPD is not just about upskilling individuals in terms of the knowledge and understanding. There's a big role to play there in terms of, we mentioned data, we mentioned technology having a big role to play going forward. We need to ensure that that's on the table and our farmers and crofters get sufficient training to allow them to understand what's actually happening on their farms and crofts, where they currently are, to benchmark where they are and know what's best to actually do to actually move them forward.
Thank you. I've got Ross Lilley and then Ross McLeod.
I'll just echo Davey, but not repeat him, that it's more important to focus on the diversity of knowledge and expertise that is across the industry and the advisory network and those of us within specialist organisations, and facilitate that rather than focus particularly on CPD at this stage. There is a standard organisation, the Chartered Institute of Environmental Managers, is a good baseline for a lot of the stuff we've been talking about, particularly on climate and biodiversity. And there's other chartered institutes, particularly forestry, that can come in here in terms of setting a standard. But I think the important thing is Tier 4, the way it's framed at the moment, could be better framed as being a cross-cutting tier rather than the fourth tier. Is actually the first tier before tier 1, tier 2, 3, and cuts across those three. And in procurement of publicly supported advice and guidance and so on out there, let's diversify that and make so it unlocks that expertise that sits amongst farmers and crofters and as much as the academic institutions out there, rather than focuses on a one institution providing that advice.
Yeah, thank you. Ross McLeod, followed by Alistair Seaman.
Thank you, Convener. Well, I don't think I could come close to Davy's just description of CPD and what's required there. I think the only thing I would add is looking at the nature of advice given to farmers at the moment. It will need to balance the focus on productive, efficient farming with biodiversity, and I'm not sure that the skill sets of those advisers at the moment are sufficient for that purpose. And that's really, really important, because as farmers try to grapple with where they could make some sacrifices in order to maintain a biodiversity outcome, that's going to be critical. Eleanor, I think, points to this as well. So just that important, making sure we balance those two competing requirements, productivity and biodiversity, is essential for those advisers to have those skill sets.
Alistair, and then David Harley.
Three things. Yes, to Farm Advisory Service, really crucial in recognising that we need to support them, so I'd like to see a plan to upskill them. Agree with Davy's point, having graduated from SRUC about a million years ago, the sad reality is that there's now less input into my specialist area of integrating trees on farms today than there was 30 years ago. So we've got to see that change. I think there are a number of us in this room who'd be really keen to be a productive part of supporting that journey. We've got real skills and expertise to bring to that, and we'd like to find a way to do that. I think peer-to-peer learning is absolutely crucial here, because we need to recognise this isn't just about skill and knowledge. It's really about, a lot of this is about culture, and a lot of this is about fear and safety, and therefore making sure that we're putting farmers who are already doing this right at the front of that is really crucial. We were running really effective crofter network gatherings, and we don't do the teaching. We get crofters to do that. So I think that's got to be really important. And then lastly, I think you asked the question, Jim, around the sort of official certification versus informal route. I'd really encourage you to go and look at what teachers are doing. I worked in education for quite a while, and they've got a really nice balance of a mixed economy where there's really high quality academic certified stuff, but also a really rich range of other things that people can just pick up and do at their own pace and in their own way, including that peer-to-peer learning, which I think is really fundamental. So some good lessons we could potentially learn from the teaching profession.
Thank you. David, and then Vicky.
Thanks. Just building on the last four or five contributions, completely agree with that. CPD has a role, but not at the expense of that dedicated farm-level advice. Our experience in regulating the sector is that advice being given by people who understand farming and farmers is absolutely crucial. And I think that culture point that Alistair raised is really at the heart of this. I think it's not so much about education or information provision. It's really around that culture, and that's a very sophisticated and something we need to really invest in. I'd be happy for a conversation around that.
Thank you, Vicky.
Thanks. I mean, clearly, we could talk a lot about this. It's a clearly important issue, and how you go about delivering this is really matters, and there's a whole diversity of approaches and very sort of farmer-centred approaches. But I just wanted to add something which is about the need for this and the sort of evidence base around that. So in a paper the Scottish Government submitted to the Just Transition Commission, the figures are a little bit a while ago, but the vast majority of farmers farm based on practical agricultural experience. And of course, that's important, so about 72%. But only 28% had any formal agricultural training. And just over 1% of those managing farms in Scotland, this was in 2016, said they had undergone any kind of vocational training in the last 12 months. If we compare that with countries like Germany and the Netherlands, where 70% of farmers have had formal training, 60% in France. It just highlights how much there is to do. And we're increasingly asking farmers to do more diverse and more complex things. And I think we're doing them a disservice if we don't put in place the mechanisms, the investment, the ways of helping them through that process and upskilling, and whether that's through mandatory or whether that's voluntary or all of those kind of mix of approaches. But the need for it is absolutely essential, I think.
Thank you. Jim?
It's more a question for the Cabinet Secretary, to be honest.
OK. That's us arrived at the end of our session very much on time, so I very much appreciate... I wonder how many Maltesers I get for becoming 15 seconds of our deadline. But thank you all very much for your valued contributions, and that will help us former views when we move towards stage one report. I'm now going to suspend the meeting for 10 minutes to allow witnesses to leave and give members a short comfort break. Our third item of business is consideration of two UKSI consent notifications, the movement of goods Northern Ireland to Great Britain, animal feed and food, plant and health, etc., Regulations 2024, and the amendment to the definition of qualifying Northern Ireland goods, EU exit regulation 2020. Do any members have any comments on either of these notifications? No. Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notifications being included in the UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Yes. And that concludes our business in public. Can I move into private session?